Good morning. This is a meeting of the Senate Committee on Appropriations. Senator Jean Hunoff, I want to welcome all of you that are in attendance and our home listening audience. We are starting our bill hearing process. First thing I guess I would like, I'd ask Secretary to take roll.
Senator Greenfield.
Here.
Senator Johnson.
Here.
Senator Colbeck.
Here.
Senator Maher.
Here.
Senator Nesbitt.
Here.
Senator Sutton.
Here.
Senator Wick.
Here.
Senator Breitling.
Here.
And Senator Hunoff.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. Well, again, welcome everyone. Just as a reminder, if you're going to speak, please sign into the sheet. Now, I know you, we have five bills today, and you've all gone before the policy committee. So what I'm going to ask is this. We have some of the information. Provide an overview of the information that you have for us, keeping in mind that, you know, we've heard some of it, but there will be opportunity for questions for the committee to clarify. So we've got five bills, so I'm looking about 25 minutes, you know, to a half hour for both proponent and opponent testimony and to allow questions. So please keep that in mind. And with that, we will get started. And the first, oh. We will start with our Pledge of Allegiance. I'll ask everyone to stand, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Yes. Thank you for the reminder, Senator. We have pages. We'd like you to come to the microphone and please introduce yourself and tell us who you are, where you're from, and if your exciting future plans.
I am Brianna Roth. I am from Redfield, and next year I will be attending Morningside University to study counseling psychology and criminal justice.
Very good. Welcome.
Good morning. My name is Kinsey Peterson. I live on a ranch in Parade, and I'm a junior at Dupree High School.
Any thoughts of the future?
Not really.
Great.
Probably a tech school, LATI, I'm looking at right now.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you for being here and helping us out. With that, we will now get started. We'll start with Senate Bill 133. This is to make an appropriation to the Board of Regents to upgrade an education lab and purchase resources at Black Hills State University and to declare an emergency. Proponents.
Good morning, Madam Chairman.
Good morning.
State Senator Ryan Maher, District 28, which encompasses all of northwestern South Dakota. Senate Bill 133 is a request for $77,792 for science education. An effective science educator can ignite interest in science in the science beginning in elementary school and provide an appropriate content and experience through high school and graduation. Black Hills State's education program plays a vital role in preparing highly qualified science teachers in this region in both an elementary and secondary science levels. The strength of the claim is documented as Black Hills State is the only BO, Board of Regents institution that earned full accreditation with no stipulations from the Council of Accreditation for Education Preparation under newly released national accreditation standards. The facility strives to maintain this accomplishment by upgrading their facilities to state-of-the-art science education and lab space and equipment. This request is for a lab station on wheels at $10,294, a science station resource and materials for $9,362, a technology kit for $32,540, a microscopy for $21,756, and then some storage for the materials and resources for $3,840. Madam Chair, Dr. Betsy Silva is here from the Black Hills State. She's the Dean of the Education Department, and she's very excited to tell you what she has in mind. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Other proponents?
Madam Chair, just to give
you just want to, I'm going to stop
sorry.
You. Identify yourself for the home audience.
Okay, I'm Thank sorry. I am Betsy Silva, and I'm Dean for Education and Behavioral Sciences at Black Hills State. Thank you, Representative Maher. So essentially what we're doing is looking at improving our K-12 teacher preparation programming. And most K-12 educators do not have a science room. So this is a mobile lab All the equipment can be taken from room to room. And it will really help our science educators that are learning to practice. They can teach lessons off of this lab so that when they do go out into the public schools, they're very confident and ready to teach off of that. The other piece of this is, with the technologies that we have now, we can also have our pre-service teachers teaching students that are across the state. Mostly, a lot of times in the rural districts, we don't have a lot of opportunities for new teaching techniques and methodologies. So our pre-service teachers, under the guidance of an expert, certified qualified teacher, university professor, can then also help with the learning and teaching process across the state.
Further proponents? Are there any other proponents? Seeing none, are there any opponents? Good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Haley Goetz with the Bureau of Finance and Management. I'm here today asking you to please oppose Senate Bill 133. As you've heard, this bill appropriates just under $78,000 to the Board of Regents to upgrade an educational lab and purchase some resources for the Black Hills State University. BH has an ongoing operating budget that totals $13.5 million. And as I just stated, this bill appropriates just under $78,000. That is only 0.5% of their total operating budget. If this was a priority for BH, they should be able to find just a little flexibility within their current budget to do this. Going even further, if this was a priority and I really don't have any funding for this, then they should have submitted a budget request to the Board of Regents. This request was not brought to the board at all. So if something was a priority to me, I'd try to work within my own budget or I would seek additional funding. I urge the committee to please oppose Senate Bill 133 and I will stand by for questions.
Thank you. Any other opponents? Any other opponents? Senator Maher, do you have rebuttal?
Madam Chair, State Senator Ryan Maher. The only thing I would add is when we get into questioning, we can dive into the budget issue. And I know Dr. Silva has some financial information about what is in her budget and what isn't in her budget and what she is able to accomplish and what she's not able to accomplish. And we can ask those questions during question and answer. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, I'll open up the committee for questions.
Madam Chair.
Senator Nesba.
I would have a question for Dr. Silva.
Madam Chair.
And Madam Chair, my question would just be, how for people who are going out into teach, how popular are these, this sort of the cart or the mobile lab that you would be using at Black Hills State? How popular are these? Basically, do most of the high schools have these sorts of carts available? And I don't know anything about high school teaching at all, so I just have no idea how this practice matches what's going on in the high schools.
Thank you.
I presume it's high schools.
Actually, this is focused more on the K-8. High schools do very frequently, typically, have their own laboratory areas with the science tables and so on. This is to encourage the K-8 pre-service teachers to include more science, which would lead to more interest in nursing, more interest in research, more interest in medicine, forestry, anything related to the science fields. And that's where the equipment and the use of this, once a public school has it, and they have the materials at their disposal, it's just that in the K-8, they don't have a dedicated space. So that they typically have, you know, like a lot of times they'll have a music room or they'll have, you know, the gymnasium for PE, but they don't have dedicated space for science. And if we don't have our science and we don't have competence and confidence teaching it, then we're not encouraging our students in second grade, third grade, fourth grade to become involved and become passionate and move into the fields that are so desperately needed economically in South Dakota.
But Madam Chair, just as a follow-up, do you think that half of the K-8 schools have some sort of mobile approach like this? Or, I mean, I don't expect you to have actual data on that, but maybe speculate a little bit about how applicable this would be for schools across the state?
Yes, several schools have the type of equipment, but a lot of the pre-service teachers don't have the comfort and the confidence to use it. When we were researching this, we did reach out to the schools that had some types of equipment and what do you have? What can we match, something similar, so that what we have, now what we have would be a compilation of what's being used in a lot of different places so that we're not gearing to a specific district, so that our teachers, when they graduate, can go anywhere in this state and be comfortable with their teaching.
Madam
Senator Maher.
I'm going to have Dr. Silva, before she leaves, address your budget and what your budget looks like for your department and why this can't be filled internally.
Madam Chair, that would be our entire budget for the College of Education and Behavioral Sciences. We would have no travel. We would have no equipment or supplies. When we can, it sounds like a lot of money when it's rattled off as a big picture, but once it gets shared out, just like a home budget, sounds like a lot till you start trying to buy the gas and the groceries. So that is our budget for education and behavioral sciences. So you're welcome.
Don't leave. I have a question.
Yes.
I'm trying to assimilate, all right?
Yes,
I'm a nurse, and so you're talking about this mobile lab. So this is for someone who's going to go out in the teaching world so they have a comfort zone in what kind of things you could have at a K through 8 program, and so then they have the different tools that are there and how to use them, and then when I leave education and I get hired by Faith School District and I go to their superintendent, I say, okay, can we have this mobile lab because I know and it can be innovative and we can get the... Is that the thought process here?
Sort of. We're calling it a mobile lab, but it's basically all the different types of equipment on a cart. So maybe laboratory, that we're getting too specific in the use of that term. It's a mobile teaching station. I mean, we're talking things like rubber bands and cotton balls and, you know, what happens with water when it goes through a siphon and things like that. So microscopes so that they can look at slides. So it's... You know, a teaching station might be a better term for it than a mobile lab. But yes, we want, when you get hired and go to Faith School System, you have the capability, the methods and the techniques to work with those K-8 students, even if all you have is you can go to Walmart and buy some different types of supplies that are in a bin on this cart. So not every school would need to have the whole cart by any means. It's all the different types of equipment in a mobile teaching station. Does that help?
Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I've got a question for the young lady from BFM. You told us that there was money or could possibly be money available within the budget for Black Hills to fund this here. Can you help the committee out here a little bit on any reversions that were reverted back to the general fund and what type of funds those were? And if any of those funds could have been available at this point to use for this funding of this mobile teaching station?
Madam Chair. And I can't speak specifically to this department. When I looked at this bill, I looked at BH as a whole. And so just looking at last fiscal year, they didn't revert very much general funds as a whole university, only about $70 in general funds. They had $2.5 million federal fund expenditure authority, $8.5 million other fund expenditure authority. But if you look at FY20, the Black Hills reverted just under $43,000 in general funds total, and then $2.1 million federal fund expenditure authority, and then $4.3 million other fund expenditure authority. And like I said, that's total for all of BH.
Okay, just to clarify then, because what funds would have been available for them to use towards this program, like the other federal fund authority, would that have been available that they reverted back, or just the general funds of $43,000 that they reverted back? Thank you.
Madam Chair, I'm not sure exactly their other fund or federal fund funding source off the top of my head. That's just their authority. Whether they had cash available behind that, I'm not sure. And I'm getting a nod behind me, so.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you.
We have a question. Senator Breitling.
My question is for Ms. Forney. Good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning. I just want to walk through, what is the process for the Regential Schools to request budget authorization for specific projects, and then the Board of Regents process for ranking, and then bringing those forward?
Sure. Madam Chair. Heather Forney, System Vice President for Finance and Administration for the Board of Regents. So from a board perspective, we have what we call informal budget presentations, which are done in June at our board meeting, where campuses will bring all of their priorities, the things that they're requesting to move forward from the board's perspective on budget. The board takes all that information into consideration, and then later at our August retreat, typically the board will have gone through that whole laundry list of requests from the campuses and determine what things they would like to move forward as the system's budget request, including a prioritization of base funding, one-time funding, and capital funding of all of those items. I will tell you from a separate perspective, from a campus perspective, there are things that they make the determination whether they're going to budget those within the existing, you know, do they have funds available? And I think that's maybe what Ms. Goetz was referring to from BFM. I think what she was trying to say is that BH would have the ability to fund this internally through their budgets. And again, to the point from the department head, that what happens from a campus perspective is they say, these are the funds that we have available to us. In most situations, general funds are used for people and utilities, and that's all. They're not using them for program expenditures. They'll use federal funds if they can, and I know for a fact that from BH's perspective, they have no federal grants available to fund this type of equipment, and then they would go to their other funds, which would be things like tuition and fees. And from a campus perspective, typically they'll say, this is what we're going to have available to us in tuition and fees, and these are the campus, you know, where we really need to focus our attention from a campus perspective. And so I believe what Ms. Goetz was trying to say is that this wasn't funded from that campus tuition fee other fund component, if I'm reading her mind.
That's very helpful. One more time, can I have you reiterate the general fund focus is for salaries, wages, and
utilities.
Typically
okay. Utilities.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing none, I will close this hearing to public testimony and open it up for discussion and or action.
Madam Chair, I'll make a do pass motion on Senate Bill 133.
It's been moved by Senator Maher and seconded by Senator Greenfield, do pass on Senate Bill 133. Any comments on that motion, Senator?
I just think that if we're going to have a K-12 teaching university out in Western South Dakota, we got to funnel some funds so they can keep at the breast of the technology and moving forward and keeping our K-12 teachers abreast of what's happening out there.
Thank you. Any other comments? Hearing none. Oh, Senator, did you have? Okay. Hearing none, we have a do pass motion on Senate Bill 133. Those in favor will signify by saying aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Greenfield?
Aye.
Senator Johnson?
Aye.
Colbeck?
No.
Maher?
Aye.
Nezuba?
Aye.
Sutton?
Aye.
Wick?
No.
Breitling?
Aye.
And Senator Hunoff?
Aye.
7-2.
By majority vote, Senate Bill 133 has passed. Senator Maher, I'll have you carry that on the floor. All right. Next bill is Senate Bill 96. This is to make an appropriation to the Board of Regents to renovate the science laboratories in the Churchill-Haines building at the University of South Dakota. Proponents, good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Madam Chair. State Senator Ryan Maher, District 28, Northwestern, South Dakota. It's kind of interesting that I have probably have the dubious record of always voting against Regent bills, and here I am pitching one today. But I found this interesting. When we were working on Senate Bill 55, I had the opportunity to tour the campus at USD. And during that tour, we were taken through Churchill-Haines, and we were looking at that particular facility. The facility itself was built in about 1970-something, 71, 72, somewhere in there. And as we were going through there, they were showing us the laboratories that haven't been updated since that time. And there's instances where there are hood stations where you go in and you work on your experiments, and the pathogens and chemicals can be lifted up through a ventilation system and filtered out. And many of them in these laboratories are inoperable. They're used as merely storage facilities, or they're rusted completely shut, or they're just completely inoperable. Along with that, then you've got cabinetry that's just literally crumbling and falling apart from years and years of use. And so these laboratories are in really, really bad shape. And I was sitting there, and I'm looking at this, and I was just in kind of awestruck that you could have a facility, a research university, where most of their biology and chemistry takes place in this kind of condition. At the same time, we go over to the dome, and the Dakota Dome, and we're looking at a football stadium. And once again, my mouth hits the floor that we could still be in South Dakota looking at a facility that's, you know, $40, $50, $60 million facility, and just across campus you have a laboratory that's in that kind of shape. And so I asked the president at that time, I was like, how do you justify putting all your resources into a stadium, but yet at the same time your laboratory, your core portion of your university that you're supposed to be a research institution, is in that kind of shape? And she's like, it's the state of the economy, it's the state of society. We can raise money to build stadiums. We can't raise money for education purposes. And so it's just a complete reflection on where society is today, that we are willing to put money into stadiums for our sole purpose of entertainment, but yet the sole purpose of the university was to educate a populace and move forward to make humanity better. And so we have this complete paradigm in higher education where the public wants the entertainment value, but they don't want the education value. And so I'm sitting here looking at this, and so I was perplexed by all this. And so then we come back here, and we have a letter of intent that we're looking at. And we're going to repeal that letter of intent in this room this summer. And I was like, wait a minute. We just put $6.7 million in 2008 into Churchill-Haines. What the heck happened to that money? So then I started digging into this. Where did that money go? So in that bill in 2008, we did a system-wide to all six universities, got some kind of science laboratory updates. Well, Churchill-Haines was the recipient of about $6.7 million, as I stated. And in that, they went through and they were able to update the electrical, the HVAC, and a few of the laboratories. We've never completed a project. We started in 2008. We put $6.7 million into a building that's never been completed. The infrastructure's there, but the rest of it's not done. And so, once again, we have another project in state government that state government started, but we've never completed. And so here's our opportunity. We have one-time money to go in and actually finish a project that happened, that we started in 2008. So with that, Madam Chair, there's a gentleman from USD here to talk about the situation, or the current, Mr. Kurt, if you want to come forward, he can finish telling the story. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Good morning and welcome. Please identify yourself for the home audience.
Good morning, Madam Chair. My name is Kurt Hackamer. I'm the Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs at the University of South Dakota. Thank you for the opportunity this morning to talk in support of Senate Bill 96, which would fund the renovation of our science labs in the Churchill-Haines building at the University of South Dakota. I want to particularly thank Senator Maher and Representative Davis for sponsoring this bill, which will affect not only the education USD delivers to its students, but also will help meet the state's ongoing need for a highly skilled and technically proficient workforce. The Churchill-Haines building has been at the heart of science education and basic research at USD since it was built in 1974. It houses our biology and chemistry departments, two large lecture halls and multiple smaller classrooms, and laboratory spaces that support everything from freshman chemistry courses to sophisticated research programs that are funded by the South Dakota Research and Commercialization Council, the National Science Foundation, and the U.S. Department of Energy. The building itself, as Senator Maher mentioned, is in great shape, but the interior spaces need modernization. Over the years, USD has made the most efficient use possible of limited funds to upgrade some of these laboratory spaces with significant renovations in 2008, 2009, and 2021, but there have never been enough resources to tackle all of our laboratory spaces. There are still labs on the north, east, and south sides of Churchill-Haines that have not been renovated in nearly 50 years. Continuing our current practice of piecemeal renovations will take years and will not make the most efficient use of available funds. Renovating these remaining laboratory spaces all at once instead of gradually updating them will result in significant savings due to increases in construction costs each year. These labs have been on the Regents M&R list for the last 12 or 13 years, but they haven't been funded. A one-time appropriation of $10 million will renovate all of the remaining laboratory spaces in Churchill-Haines, including upgrades to interior finishes, as well as upgrades to plumbing, HVAC, and electrical systems. Without that facility investment, USD will not be able to deliver the best possible education to South Dakota students, and we will risk losing faculty researchers who attract a significant amount of external research funding each year, including $7 million in grants and contracts over the last 5 years. Our world-renowned researchers are dedicated to including both undergraduate and graduate students in cutting-edge projects related to solar energy, environmental remediation, catalysis, artificial viruses, polymer chemistry, and much more. They lead the way in researching organic semiconductor materials for next-generation flexible electronics, new materials for high-capacity batteries, macromolecules and nanomaterials for sensing devices, fluorinated photonic materials for security printing to prevent counterfeiting, and biomedical imaging that can identify medical images and medical issues earlier than ever before, detection methods for identifying minute quantities of agrochemicals in our food supply, and new polymers that will lead to sustainable plastics. This basic research not only trains highly skilled workers, but it also increases the chances of high-tech industries taking root here in South Dakota. Without modern laboratory facilities, all of this is at risk. USD's chemistry department achieves the highest standards of chemistry education for programs ranging from bachelor's degree to a PhD, and has maintained accreditation from the American Chemical Society for more than 80 years. The department has produced many of the university's national award winners, including Rhodes, Goldwater, and Fulbright scholars, as well as National Science Foundation graduate research fellows. Its majors have entered local industry, become medical doctors and dentists, are teaching in K-12 schools and universities across the state, and have continued on to professional or graduate school. But the labs themselves affect far more than just chemistry students. Every semester, approximately 600 students per week from all across the university use the Churchill-Haines labs. There are education majors who will become science teachers across the state, biology majors who will monitor water quality, staff our state parks, and work at state and federal agencies that preserve South Dakota's natural beauty, and pre-med and health science students for whom chemistry lab experiences are required before they can become the doctors, nurses, physician assistants, occupational therapists, and physical therapists who will work at Sanford Health, Avera Medical Group, Monument Health, and Veterans Affairs facilities. These labs and the research opportunities they provide help keep South Dakota's brightest students in the state for their college education. No one illustrates this better than Frank Leibfarth, a 2008 graduate from Yankton, South Dakota. I remember Frank's case well because I was an associate dean in our College of Arts and Sciences who worked with a team from across campus to make sure that this extraordinarily bright student stayed in state and went to USD. Frank's potential was obvious to anyone who met him, and he was heavily recruited by both in-state and out-of-state schools. As we talked to him, it was clear that access to meaningful research experiences was very important to Frank, and he ultimately decided on USD after meeting faculty, learning about the research projects in their labs, and hearing about their commitment to integrating undergraduate students into their research teams. He started his first research experience on campus the summer before his freshman year, and he never looked back. ultimately conducting research at USD Center for the Research and Development of Light Activated Materials. By the time he graduated, he was a Goldwater Scholar, the first student athlete in North Central Conference history to be named to USA Today's All-USA College Academic Team and the USD football team's all-time leading scorer. His list of honors since graduating would take far too much of your time, but there's one that stands out. This fall, Popular Science magazine included Frank in an article titled The Brilliant 10, the Most Innovative Up-and-Coming Minds in Science, where they highlighted his work on creating a filter that can remove toxins from polluted waterways. Frank is an example of what can happen when our South Dakota kids are provided life-changing opportunities close to home. But even though USD students and researchers have experienced incredible success over the years, more often than not, it is despite our facilities rather than because of our facilities. Senate Bill 96 can help ensure the future of both education and world-class research at the University of South Dakota for decades to come. We are grateful to Senator Maher and Representative Davis for sponsoring the bill. We appreciate the opportunity to talk about this need today, and we look forward to answering any questions you might have about how we can best serve the state of South Dakota. Thank you.
Thank you. Further proponents for Senate Bill 96. Further proponents. Seeing none, do we have opponents? Opponents to Senate Bill 96. Seeing none, I will open it up for questions. Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Madam Chair. For the gentleman who just spoke, I want to thank you for being here. And I guess when the senator was pitching the bill, I just wanted to go back to the appropriation that was made for $6.7 or $6.8 million a decade and a half ago and ask the question, were those funds expended entirely for the Churchill-Haines building?
Madam Chair, yes, they were.
And they were exhausted?
Yes, they were.
Okay.
As Senator Maher mentioned, there was a lot of basic HVAC and systems infrastructure that had to be put in place first before you could get to lab renovations. And once the core infrastructure was in place, then the rest of the money was used to renovate labs as far as we could make the money spend out.
Madam Chair, I did see that somebody else was coming forward, maybe.
This is someone who will know the finances much better than I will.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Jessica Preister, Assistant Vice President for the University of for Finance for University of South Dakota. Senator Greenfield, to answer your question, yes, those funds were fully expended. And if I can refer you to the handout that we provided, if you see on the map, the room shaded in red were the rooms that were completed using those funds. The room shaded in green would be the labs that would be renovated with the funding this bill might provide.
And Madam Chair, follow up. Thank you, Madam Chair. In your estimate, first of all, I noticed you didn't use any blue or gold in your coloration, but will this bill satisfy the needs at Churchill-Haines, at least for the immediate future?
Yes, they will. This will take care of all of the remaining lab spaces as outlined there and bring them up to the pictures as noted on the right.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you both for being here.
Thank you.
Okay. Other questions? Yep. Senator Nisbet.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. Do we... The $10 million looks like it was just sort of grabbed out of the air. Do you have any estimates or do you have any more detailed budget somewhere that you could share with us to just persuade us that it isn't just a number picked out of the air?
Madam Chair, thank you. I do. The square footage of the space highlighted in green is approximately 25,000 square feet. And in an early construction estimates, we usually use a cost per square foot. So that comes out to $400 per square foot, which includes the equipment needed in that renovation.
Okay. Do you have a follow-up?
No.
All right. Any other questions?
Madam
Chair. Senator Breitling.
My question is for Ms. Forney one more time. you for joining us again. I just want to understand the process. This is not on our list as a Board of Regents recommendation. Can you walk us through how the request went through and how we got to today?
Sure, Madam Chair. Heather Forney, System Vice President for Finance and Administration for the Board of Regents again. So the Churchill-Haines lab renovations that are before you today were not a request made by USD during any of our budget process with the board. So they were not presented as any type of an informal request in June, and so thus was not an option for our discussion and recommendation in August. So to give you a little bit of history on how the maintenance and repair process works with our system, we really have three pots of money. One would be general funds, which we've been receiving from you since, you know, for the last 10 years or so. HEF, maintenance and repairs, which are generated at 11.5% from tuition. And then there's an M&R fee, which is a small component that is also generated on campus. We ask each of the campuses, they're given an allocation, and it's based on the square footage, the replacement value, and revenue that they generate. So there's a formula that we develop to determine how much of an M&R allocation they'll receive from HEF. We estimate how much they'll collect for the fee on the campus, and then we use the same kind of concept minus the revenue component to allocate out general fund maintenance and repair dollars. Since 2013, I think USD has received about $71 million in maintenance and repair funding out of all three of those buckets. And I believe since 2013, they've expended about $750,000 on renovations for labs at Churchill-Haines. So that process also, once we know how much their allocation will be in each of those buckets, we ask them to put together a list. What is it that they intend to do with the funding and what projects they want to utilize. And then the board approves those in typically December for the HEF funding, and then usually in that May board meeting timeframe for the general funds, because we'll know what those are. And so when the campus determines what their priorities are, how they want to fund their maintenance and repair, they do it within those guidelines.
Reiterate that one more time. Since 2013, the M&R was $71 million. Is that correct?
For USD, that's correct. And in all three of those buckets, general funds, HEF, and then the
for all three. Okay.
For all three.
Okay. And then maintenance specific to Churchill-Haines was $700,000.
$750,000, yep. Since 2013.
Okay.
Any further questions, Senator Wick?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I guess my question would be, since we are spending M&R dollars, and I don't know who can answer this, without this bill, how long would it take to finish Churchill-Haines? I thought I may have heard that go by, but I'm kind of in another world this morning.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Jessica Breister again from the University of South Dakota. We have a 10-year M&R list that we submit to the board each year, and the projects in Churchill-Haines are kind of sparsed out over the next 10 years.
So if I understood that correctly, if we don't do this today, it's going to take at least 10 years to get rid of the old rusty hoods that Senator Maher referred to.
Madam Chair, correct.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. Any other questions? Okay, then I will close this hearing to public testimony and open it up for discussion interaction.
Madam Chair.
Senator Wick.
I would move due pass on Senate Bill 96.
It's been moved by Senator Wick, seconded by Senator Colbeck, due pass on Senate Bill 96. Comments on that motion?
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. I would say that, we can either wait 10 years and maybe the next Frank isn't going to come along and be able to be taught at USD, or we can keep things moving along, and I would say we should spend the money and support this bill and get things cleaned up and working right.
Thank you. With Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Something kind of hit me a little bit when Senator Maher was up giving the introduction to this bill. He talked about a 60 or less million dollar sports arena, and he talked about a place where we can educate and move people through the educational system and make them work or get them to work and stay in South Dakota as very productive citizens. I've often said to our educational systems, do you want trophies or do you want to educate your students so they become productive citizens in the state of South Dakota? That kind of touched me a little bit on this here particular issue with this $10 million. So I'm going to support this, and I seconded the motion, and that was the reason why. I don't believe that our universities and our K-12 should look at a situation where all they want is trophies. I think that they should look at a system like this, and I think they should work at the education of our students and the young people that want to get involved in a particular major and continue on with the research and the science that that would make them a very, very productive citizen in the state of South Dakota and a good family atmosphere. So I am going to promote that or promote this bill, and I would recommend a yes vote on this. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Breitling.
You know, there's folks in this room that get frustrated when we don't follow the process. And, you know, $77,000, we can say whatever we want, but it's $77,000. $10 million is a completely different conversation. We're bypassing the system. We're bypassing the process. We're angry that the Board of Regents doesn't do their job. And then here we're just ignoring Board of Regents. We're ignoring USD leadership. And we're going through and requesting $10 million to make an investment. And so I'm going to encourage a no vote. USD needs to master plan what their facility responsibilities are. They need to bring a request to the Board of Regents. Board of Regents needs to rank them, and then we need to make that decision on funding at that time. So I encourage a no vote.
Thank you. I just have a comment. Blue and gold is my favorite color. However, I know Frank personally, so you sort of came through on that one. So thank you. With that, the vote, Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Relative to the voice of opposition, I would just say I appreciate Senator Maher for being such a student of the game. He dredges up things from old minutes and what have you, and has a better memory than I do relative to some of these issues. And to the extent that he was plugged into the Churchill-Haines issue it rang a bell when the letter of intent was up this last year. I think that's why this is before us. I don't think that we're stepping on the process. I think that the senator identified something that just frankly doesn't make sense. If we're going to have invested in half of the building project in one fell swoop, it's probably appropriate to take care of the remainder in another concerted effort rather than piecemealing it together for over the next 10 years. So I hope that the regental system doesn't feel as though we're stepping on their toes or what have you. But I do think that to the extent that a legislator has identified something as a priority and it does make sense to me, I would hope that we can support this. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Johnson.
Thank you. I would just suggest, if I could, if we do a tour again, JCA, it would be nice to tour this Churchill-Haines building.
Thank you. With that being said, the motion is due pass on Senate Bill 96. Those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Greenfield?
Aye.
Senator Johnson?
Aye.
Senator Kolbeck?
Aye.
Senator Maher?
Aye.
Senator Nezeba?
Aye.
Senator Sutton?
Aye.
Senator Wick?
Aye.
Senator Breitling?
Nope.
And Senator Hunhoff?
Aye.
By the majority of the committee vote, Senate Bill 96 has been approved and will go to the floor. Yes, you need a title. No.
No, I forgot to move an amendment.
Okay.
We can do,
we
that
do
that
it on the floor. Do it on the floor. Because I dropped the gavel.
Yes. I got so caught up in the emotional testimony, I forgot to do my job.
Well, then you got to make a motion to reconsider.
Madam Chair.
Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would move that we reconsider the vote by which Senate Bill 96 passed.
Second.
Yes. It was moved by Senator Greenfield to reconsider Senate Bill 96 as passed. And who seconded? Senator Wick. Comments on that motion? Nope. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. We will reconsider. Senator Maher.
Madam Chair, I have an amendment at the desk. It's 96A as alpha.
Is that online?
Yes.
Do you want to read that amendment?
I would. I do. In there, it creates another section, and it's just, I'll just read it to you real quick. The administration of the design and construction for the project authorized in this act shall, under the general charge and supervision of the Bureau of Administration as provided in chapters 5-14. It's an amendment that came from Nathan Lucas over at the Regental office, and it's standard language that needs to be included in this Appropriation Act.
Aye.
I don't know that we need a title amendment now. I'm not sure, but
I don't believe so. I think this is consistent with the intention of the bill. Madam Chair. Thank you, Madam Chair. I would move due pass on Senate Bill 96 as amended.
Second.
It's been moved by Senator Greenfield and seconded by Senator Wick. Do approve Senate Bill 96 as amended. Any comments on that motion? Senator Nesba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I am supportive of this amendment and the bill. One of the things that we have talked about, and I was surprised that the good senator representing all of Northwest South Dakota didn't mention, is that he's planning to amend another bill when we're looking at the state health lab, and they do have some lab materials and hoods and things there that might be able to be used by the Board of Regents, and I think you're going to have that at no cost to them. So just so you keep that in mind, that there might be some materials you can harvest from the state health lab at no cost and bring that, make sure you can make that make those numbers add up. So thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. With that, the motion before you is do pass Senate Bill 96 as amended. Those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Greenfield.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Colbeck.
Aye.
Maher.
Aye.
Nesba.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Wick.
Aye.
Breitling.
Nope.
And Hunoff.
Aye. By majority motion, Senate Bill 96 has been approved and will go to the floor as amended. Senator Maher, will you carry that? All right, folks, we have an hour and 10 minutes left. So both testifiers and committee, please keep that in mind. We're going to move to Senate Bill 43, which authorizes the Board of Regents to contract for the design, renovation, and construction of an addition for a health science center at Black Hills State University, Rapid City, to make an appropriation, therefor, and to declare an emergency. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. I'm Lori Nichols, and I serve as president at Black Hills State University. Senate Bill 43 authorizes construction of an addition to the Black Hills State University Rapid City facility located on Cheyenne Boulevard. The West River Health Science Center, as you have heard before, is really focused on nursing. And just to hit a couple of the highlights, I know you've heard this before, but I'll refresh your memory, that this is a very strong collaboration between Black Hills State University and South Dakota State University. BH will do the pre-nursing curriculum in 3 semesters and an associate degree for applied health science, and then very seamlessly transfer those students to SDSU's BSN program for a nursing degree. The reason for the addition really has to do more with SDSU's nursing program, and this is an effort to move them fully from their current location in Rapid City on 11th Avenue into our building, the Black Hills State University Rapid City facility, the entire nursing program. We think that many things can happen with that, better collaboration, certainly better marketing and recruitment, but most importantly, we plan to grow the number of nursing students, so we're producing more nurses for the Rapid City workforce needs. I know there's been question about why do we need to add on to the building? Why can't we just use the current facility? And I'd like to address that for you. In doing a really strong space analysis of our Rapid City facility, we in fact determined that we could turn over about 50% of our facility to the West River Health Science Center and to nursing, and we have done that. So currently, we have SDSU's nursing program in the building, and they are doing all of their didactic classes there now, which is essentially their lecture classes. They are in our classrooms. Every day, they are teaching their classrooms or their lecture classrooms in the building. In addition, SDSU offers an accelerated nursing program in Rapid City. That program has fully moved into the Rapid City facility, our facility, Black Hill State facility. So we already accommodate them as well. And we have moved in about 5 to 6 staff that are now fully housed there too. So we have brought over as much as we can, and we're doing as much as we can in the current facility. I do want to remind you that we continue to do what we used to do there as well, and that is we are educating 500 additional students out of Rapid City today that are pursuing an elementary ed degree, a business degree, a psychology degree, a sociology degree. So we have other things going on in the building too, and we are accommodating about 500 students through those programs as well. What we cannot do now, and this is why we need the facility improvement, is we have no skills lab, and we don't have space for them right now. We have no simulation lab space, and we do not have space for 20 faculty offices. So that is what the addition is needed, is to bring the rest of the nursing program over and fully accommodate the curriculum and what they need in order to teach nursing at the facility. I'd be happy to answer any other questions, but in a nutshell, that is why we need this. And I'll just wrap up by saying that the projected cost of this wing addition is $15 million. We're proposing that the project be funded by a request to you of $8 million from the Federal American Rescue Plan Capital Projects Fund, so the federal funding through COVID. We will use an additional $5.1 million from the Higher Education Facilities Fund, and we will solicit at least $2 million in private support to help get this project done. Thank you. Further proponents? Are there further proponents for Senate Bill 43? Again, welcome, and please identify yourself.
Good morning, Madam Chair and Committee. I'm Paulette Davidson. I serve as the president and CEO for Monument Health. Monument Health is the largest healthcare system in western South Dakota. We provide care in our hospitals, our ambulatory clinics. We provide care in our home settings, in our assisted livings, long-term care. We do that through really great people. And great people who are well educated and great people who are well trained. And these are healthcare professionals, and I'm very proud of the mission that we have in Western South Dakota. We care for approximately 450,000 people in Western South Dakota, and we take great pride in doing that. I'm here today to support Senate Bill 43, which really came out of the work through Senate Bill 55. I had the opportunity to serve on the task force for Senate Bill 55, learned a great deal, specifically served on the subcommittee for academics. And I'm very proud of that work. We took a lot of time to look at the future needs of our state, of our workforce, and looked at our academic programs within the regental system, and realized we have some opportunities. We have opportunities to create a more efficient university system, but tie it to the needs of our state, particularly in the area for today, nursing, and what the West River Health Science Center offers in West River. We have a great need today for nurses, registered nurses. We will have a greater need for registered nurses in the future, because we have to plan for our future and the needs of our communities. The West River Health Science Center will prepare us for the future. Today, I think you've heard in the past, conversations and committee meetings, we have a need for over 1,700 nurses today in our state. I can tell you today in Western South Dakota, just within Monument Health, we are employing over 250 nurses from outside of our state to take care of our current health care needs. That's 250. We call them traveler nurses. It's not sustainable to continue to bring in nurses from other places. We're making grounds, we're making progress in recruiting nurses, we're investing in programs. This is a program, the West River Health Science Center is about our future and growing our nursing programs, growing students who live and want to work in Western South Dakota to take care of our communities and our residents. It's critical. It's critical today, but it's critical as we look to the future, how we're going to take care of our families and residents. A nurse in Rapid City takes care of people that might live in Phillip, that might live in Hot Springs. It's not just that community, it's the region. So please consider our request today. Please consider the future for West River. Thank you.
Thank you. Further proponents? Is there anyone else in the room? Again, new information, why we support, or me too.
Good morning, madam. My name is Chris Simons, and I am a registered nurse, and I am currently the chief nursing officer at Black Hills Surgical Hospital. Thank you for having me. There's nothing I enjoy more than to talk about nursing. I've been a nurse in South Dakota for the last 20 years. I'm passionate about caring for others, and this is why I'm here today asking you to support Senate Bill 43. I'll just echo what Paulette said, the nursing shortage. I look at you fully in your eyes telling you it is real. It will directly and indirectly affect every single person in this room, and it's much easier to bring a nurse home, and when I mean home, South Dakota, if we train and educate them within the state. The West River Health Science will not only help us staff our hospitals, clinics, long-term care, nursing homes, but it will also utilize for further education. As a nurse, your education does not stop when you graduate. Technology and everything continues to educate every single day. So in order to attract nurses to our state, we have to spend a considerable amount of time and money to tackle this together. We're coming here to collaborate together. I've heard statistics that up to 2,000 open positions within South Dakota, and we're currently graduating 600 to 700. It's not sustainable, and it doesn't account for the amount of nurses that are retiring or getting out of the field, and they're tired, they're worn out, and I think this will further support the efforts to provide relief and also education. So I'm here just to ask, please support SB 43 and tackle this nursing shortage together. So thank you for your time, Madam Chair.
Thank you. I'd like to see those that are in the direct patient care come testify before us. Thank you. Any other proponents in the room? Good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. I'm Brian Maher. I'm the Executive Director and CEO at the South Dakota Board of Regents. Chairman Hunhoff, I heard you clearly, so I'll make this as quick as I can. First of all, why support Senate Bill 43? It's collaboration, and I think it's collaboration at its finest. We have two of our institutions paired to take care of this workforce development issue, West River, and not only that, they've had great collaboration with the healthcare industry as well. Secondly, it's efficient. We've taken information from the past, and we have consolidated, number one, the number of institutions who are providing healthcare in the area, and two, we are going to do this from one site. So we're not only consolidating the number of universities, we're consolidating the locations where this will take place. Another issue I would raise that you've already heard is that we have great partners with the workforce and our industry partners in the Black Hills area. I believe this is a great example of the work that has come from Senate Bill 55. Likely we're not here in front of you today without the work that was done through Senate Bill 55 and the pushing and the prodding that Senate Bill 55 provided for the regental system. This is a board priority. This is a response to workforce development. This is good for South Dakota. We urge your support.
Thank you. Further proponents. Okay, I have someone online. Are you there?
Can you hear me, Madam Chair?
Yes, I can. Please identify yourself and welcome.
Thank you. Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. My name is Jacob Parsons. I'm a registered lobbyist for the South Dakota Association of Healthcare Organizations. As you all know, we're also known as SDAHO. SDAHO is the Hospital and Long-Term Care Association for South Dakota, representing acute and post-acute care providers, which includes all 54 hospitals across the state. We are here also in support of Senate Bill 43. This facility would help to provide education in the future for nursing, West River, and really across the state. One of the previous proponents said that she had heard 2,000 nursing openings currently in the state. Our conservative estimate is that there's at least 1,700. So I would say that she's probably spot on with that. So to save time, we ask for your favorable support of Senate Bill 43. Thank you, and I'll stand by if you have any questions.
Thank you so very much. Mr. Johnson, are you testifying?
Madam Chairman, yes. Thank you so much for your time. Hi, everyone. My name is Tom Johnson. I'm the CEO and president of Elevate Rapid City. We're Western South Dakota's Chamber of Commerce, Economic Development, and Workforce Development Agency for the Black Hills. The trade area for Rapid City often gets misrepresented of about 100,000. When we actually look at the credit card data, Rapid City's trade area is about 450,000 to 500,000. That means residents from a 5-state, 36-county region are coming to Rapid City for their health care. And so it's the second biggest industry in the Black Hills. Often folks talk about our tourism and our ag. Our top two industries are actually the military with the base, and our second is healthcare, and they're by a country mile. So we badly need this. Many of you know that we're also growing by about 3,000 people per year in the Black Hills. So we're probably likely to see about 30,000 to 40,000 people in the next 10 years, which is only going to exacerbate this problem. I just pulled our numbers this morning, and there were about 1,200 job openings for nurses in the last 12 months, our rolling average. So the Black Hills needs this very badly, Madam Chair. This also will have an economic impact of about $3.5 million in payroll and local taxes as well, just in case the committee wanted to know about the economic development benefits. So, Madam Chairman, we'd like to again thank you so much for your time and speak in support of this bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Anybody else on the line that's a proponent? Anyone else, proponent? Okay, last call in the room. Seeing none, are there any opponents? Any opponents? Seeing none, I will open up for committee questions. Any questions by the committee? Sure. Senator Breitling.
My question is for Ms. Forney or President Maher. Either or is fine. You know what my question is, Ms. Forney. So again, thank you for joining us. I just want to reiterate, this was an established priority by the department, recognized by leadership and brought forward, brought to Board of Regents, and ended up as a governor's priority as well. Can you walk through that process?
I can, Madam Chair. Go ahead. Thank you for the question. The process, as we've kind of established before, in June, campuses will bring their priorities or their requests for budget to the board in what we call an informal budget hearing. This was one of the priorities identified by Black Hills State University, one of four. The board did agree to move it forward, and so that was done at our August retreat and was included in our budget request to the governor. And I would kind of reiterate the comments that were made earlier that this is part of what happened through Senate Bill 55, was identifying the need for that nursing ramp up in West River, and this was the location that was identified.
Any other questions? Senator Johnson.
Maybe for Mr. Maher. Do you know I'm looking at the title, and this is Senate Bill 43, you know, this is going to become statute. So my question is this Black Hills, is this Health Sciences Center officially named Black Hills State University - Rapid City? I mean, is that the official name on the books?
Madam Chair, again, Brian Maher, the South Dakota Board of Regents. That is the name today, yes.
Well, I don't know if I'm opening up a can of worms here. I need help from my committee. But if it's not located within the city limits of Rapid City, how do we do that? I mean, if it's we're not in the city limits of Rapid City, we're in Box Elder. So, I mean, would that cause a problem down the road if we pass statute that says this is Rapid City? And if so, then we can fix it right now.
Madam Chair, I don't know if the question is for me or not.
Well, it will be because I certainly can't answer it. So,
Madam Chair,
Senator Wick,
I think we can call it anything we want. I think we could call it West River. We could call it Planet Mars. I mean, it doesn't matter for the sake of the bill, honestly. I mean, it's effectively for the area of Rapid City, even though it is in the city limits of Box Elder. I mean, you drive by and you see the Watiki Park signs. They say Rapid City Exit 62 or whatever it is, and I think it's clear enough.
Madam Chair.
Senator Maher.
I would say that somewhere in statute, if you were to go back and pull up the statute of where that land transfer and stuff is, it's going to be referenced in their name and in everything. I mean, as long as the legal description is right, when we reference back to that, I don't see a problem with that. And it's just a branding mechanism because they rebranded this a couple years ago and brought a whole bunch of statutes through where they rebranded this and renamed it too.
Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would also note that this doesn't actually amend code. This is a special appropriation. There's no reference to any section of code where this would be inserted.
Thank you, Mr. Maher. Excellent answer.
Any other questions? Senator Nesba.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I am generally supportive of this, but I have a question about the nursing program and nursing placement. So I don't know if it's for President Nichols or if it's for Dr. Maher or SDSU Nursing, who doesn't happen to be in the room.
I believe she's online. The Dean of Nursing is online. So who do you want the question to go to?
The Dean of Nursing at SDSU.
Fine. Dean Crow, are you on?
I am.
All right.
So could you just remind the committee again, we're expanding the number of slots there, West River. How much are we increasing the number of slots, and how much sort of unfilled or unmet capacity do we already have sort of within the SDSU Black Hills State system?
So it's Madam Chair and committee members.
Go ahead.
Again, Marianne Krog, Dean of the SDSU College of Nursing. This is a bit of a twofold question, so bear with me a little bit. When we talk about capacity, historically in our building on 11th Street, we had a capacity of 48 students per cohort, and it was really limited because of classroom space. With our ability to move over to Black Hills State University for our didactic education, we've been able to increase our capacity to 72 students per cohort. It's a tight 72 because of our lab and simulation space at our current building. But we're able to, we would be able to accommodate that. The second secondary part of that is pipeline. And so before we were able to partner with Black Hills State University for the West River Health Science Center with some shared advising and identification of students and two programs running out of the same space, it was really challenging to wrap our arms around where our pipeline is. And so we're really identifying where our pipeline is, which means the students have to have met the prerequisite requirements to come into the nursing program. What I can tell you is that our advising team in Rapid City is telling us that they are seeing more student and applicant interest coming in through their offices than they've ever seen before. Our application just closed. We've had more people asking for Rapid City as their site. So it is, we are seeing growth. We're not at 72 yet, but I think we're getting ourselves to that point. Does that answer your question, Senator Nisba?
Yeah, Madam Chair, I probably have a couple more follow-ups for Dr. Krug. Am I saying that right?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. And I thought I heard somebody this morning say that we're moving from that 72 to 120, and I see President Nichols nodding her head. And not everybody gets to grow up and be a nurse because it's hard to get admitted to that nursing program. What's the main thing that trips students up? I think we, at least one of those things I think is we require a 28 ACT and maybe some other course requirements in some courses that are hard. What's the main obstacle for students who want to be in nursing but aren't able to get into that program?
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
Senator Nisba, I would say in the pre-nursing curriculum, what tends to challenge students is some of the more hard science courses, chemistry, anatomy, physiology courses. If students work their way through that, then it really is, then the next stumbling blocks are within the nursing curriculum, which are, again, pretty heavily science focused, but important to nursing, and that is pharmacology and pathophysiology.
Right.
So we do have a lot of supports built in, and we're growing our tutoring support in the Rapid City area to try to meet that, address those needs in the West River Health Science Center as well.
And Madam Chair, my main question here is are we going to be able to grow this program without lowering those standards? Are we going to have to lower the ACT score or lower our expectations of grades in those difficult courses to be able to grow this or not? Can we hold those standards and grow this program at the same time?
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
So I would argue the approach is to provide supports for students and keep the same standards in place, because we have to remember that when students get to the other end of their educational journey, they also have a licensing exam that they have to pass to work as registered nurses. And if we lower our standards, the pass rate on that will go down, and standard of care will, the standard of care will change, but the quality of care could potentially go down. So I would argue for providing the supports that students need to be successful, but not lowering the standards. I hope that answers your question.
That does, and that's helpful. And just one final question, Madam Chair. Is it possible that a student who is enrolled in nursing at SDSU will be told that they need to transfer to West River, or just how is that decision made? If we create excess capacity in Rapid City and we still have limited capacity in Brookings, is it possible that students will be moved from SDSU to West River?
Madam Chair.
Go ahead.
So we have a centralized application process for the nursing program. So once students meet the prerequisites, they apply, and students are able to identify where they would like to do their nursing education, because we have nursing education in Aberdeen, Rapid City, Sioux Falls, and Brookings. Students who meet the criteria, but we've achieved our capacity in Sioux Falls and Brookings, will often be offered Rapid City. And then it's up to the students whether they take that seat or defer for another semester and reapply. So we do offer those slots to people when we have waiting lists. They don't always take them.
And Madam Chair, I just wanted, I wanted to understand that and understand that it might have some implications, and that might be good news for Monument Health, and it might be good news for the West River Center, that some of the demand that happens in East River will at least potentially move to West River. So thank you, Dr. Koch, for those clarifications.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Any further questions? Hearing none, I will close this hearing to public testimony and open it up for discussion or action by the committee. Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'll move to pass.
It's been moved by Senator Greenfield and seconded by Senator Kobach. Do pass on Senate Bill 43. Comments on that motion?
Madam Chair, thank you for being here today and for answering our questions. And I know we're in a crunch for time, so I'll just say this. The nursing shortage issue has been one that has plagued us for years. We've put forth efforts to try to address it. And my only thing that I'd like for you to take away from this is I know it's a broader issue, a broader problem, goes to wage offerings and what have you. So what I don't want to do is see us expand our nursing programs and ultimately supply nurses for neighboring states or other venues. So let's just keep our nose to the grindstone as it relates to this issue and do what we can here today. Thank you.
Senator Kobach.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I just want to thank the Board of Regents and Black Hills because we had a work group this summer, and one of the things that our work group really worked hard with Mr. Maher was the fact that we wanted priorities. And we wanted priorities to be brought in front of this committee that were going to benefit the total educational process and the workforce situation in the state of South Dakota. And I really want to thank them for working really hard on those priorities. And this was one of those priorities that Dr. Maher and our committee had talked about. And therefore, I will be supportive of this. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I would be amiss. Again, I'm really proud that we have a staff nurse that came and presented, because I think that's very important to see the face of those individuals that are providing that. So thank you so very much. Senator Nesba, I will answer the question you asked for Dean Crow. Biochemistry was the point, that the dipping point. That was the point where they left, and, you know, fortunately I passed, so I'm still there. So with that, the motion before you is do pass on Senate Bill 43. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Senator Kobach.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Aye.
Senator Nesba.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
And Senator Hunhoff.
Aye. By unanimous vote, Senate Bill 43 has passed and will go to the floor. With that, we will move to Senate Bill 132 to make an appropriation for multimedia lab equipment at Black Hills State University and to declare an emergency. Well, welcome back, Senator.
It's been haven't seen you for a while, Madam Chair. State Senator Ryan Maher, District 28, Northwestern South Dakota. In the interest of time, I'll keep this real brief because I have the provost for this department behind me, Ms. Pam. Anyway, this is a budget request for $112,500 for equipment and renovation of a multimedia lab as they're consolidating programs in the College of Arts and Sciences. This is one program that they need some updated equipment for. Equipment and audio recordings for $7,000, graphic design equipment for $44,500, multimedia laboratory equipment to replace outdated television station equipment for $45,000 and radio equipment for $16,000. I'll let Ms. Pam come forward and tell what they're working on there. Thank you.
Madam, thank you, Madam Chair. Committee members, I'm Pam Caribou. I'm the interim provost and vice president for academic affairs at Black Hills State University. I just really quickly, because I realize time is short, this process or SB 55 actually has caused us to take a close look at three of the programs offered at Black Hills State University. We took a close look at our speech communications major, our mass communications major, and our corporate communications majors. And we are basically updating and consolidating the three. Currently, across those three majors, we have about 70 students in those programs. And we're redesigning a communications and media major that will better meet the needs of the students and frankly, the field right now, the jobs that are available in these areas. And as we're updating the curriculum, as we're updating the majors, we also need to upgrade our equipment. Senator Maher, I don't know if you toured our TV station when you toured Black Hills State, but frankly, it looks like something out of the 1980s. It's very dated material. It's so old that we're really using more like handheld cameras and those sorts of things. And so we're asking for a small amount of money, really. It's meaningful and important to us, but a small amount of money just to upgrade our audio recording equipment, some graphic design equipment, basically a scanner, and then a laser cutter. We're asking for some multimedia equipment for our television statement for our television station, new cameras, cinema cameras, portable cameras, and then some upgraded equipment for our radio station. And the idea is that students that graduate from these programs will be able to go out. They'll work in social media, they'll work in broadcasting, they'll work in marketing, and really benefit from having equipment that is from this century. Thank you.
Thank you. Further proponents? Any further proponents? Anybody online? Okay. Are there any opponents? Familiar face back. Welcome.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Haley Getz of the Bureau of Finance and Management here again today asking you to oppose Senate Bill 132. Black Hills State brought four priorities to the board for consideration. This was not one of those that they brought to the board. Therefore, this should not be seen as a priority for Black Hills State. I urge the committee to please oppose Senate Bill 132, and I will stand by for questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Did you want a rebuttal? Nope. All right. Open it up for questions. Well, I've got a couple, and I just, it's more like, and I don't know who to ask to, but you can come forward. So you talked about a radio station that you have. Do all the universities have their own radio stations? Do you know?
Madam Chair, I do not know whether all of the universities have them. Heather, do you?
Nobody knows. Okay, because South Dakota Public Broadcasting is at USD, so I know that. But this is not public broadcasting. This is just your school-run radio station. Is that correct?
That's correct. It's KBHU.
Okay. And then how many students did you say you have in that major, in this communications major?
We have 70 students currently among those three majors, and expect that they will move into our media communications, communication and media major that we're proposing right now.
Okay. Then I have one other question, and it's probably for Ms. Forney. What's their operational budget for that department? Or who know, or it's, you don't know, it's only by the university. Do you know what your operational budget is? Just,
we actually don't have an operational budget just for this department. We have a budget for the College of Liberal Arts. And it's actually, this amount of money exceeds the amount budgeted for the college beyond faculty salaries and benefits and those sorts of things. So as Dr. Silva testified, if we used all of the college budget on these upgrades to equipment, it would eliminate faculty travel, it would eliminate support for student research, it would eliminate all of the other programs that we support using the College of Liberal Arts.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? Okay, seeing none, I will close this hearing to public testimony and open it up for discussion and or action.
Madam Chair.
Senator Maher.
I would move to pass on Senate Bill 132.
It's been moved by Senator Maher and seconded by Senator Greenfield for due pass on Senate Bill 132. Any comments on that motion?
I just think it's interesting that how different the universities are. And here you have a small university where your entire operational departmental budget is under $112,000. And you compare that to a USD or SDSU where the numbers are quite more large, I would say. So I guess I would be in favor of this because of, I mean, they're just operating on nothing out there.
Any other comments? Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In answer to one question, I don't think all the universities have radio stations, but I'm going to be looking to register KHWL, K Howell, for Aberdeen.
Thank you. With that, then, the motion before the committee is do pass on Senate Bill 132. Those in favor will signify by saying aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Johnson?
Aye.
Senator Colbeck?
Aye.
Senator Maher?
Aye.
Senator Nesba?
Aye.
Senator Sutton?
Aye.
Senator Wick?
No.
Senator Breitling?
Aye.
And Senator Hunhoff?
Aye.
By majority vote, Senate Bill 132 has passed the committee. Go to the floor. Senator Maher, you want to carry that one too? Okay. All right. Well, I am thankful to both the committee.
Can we just back up 1 second?
Yes.
Who did you want to pitch the prior bill, 43?
Well, I'd like to discuss that. I'd like to pitch it if I could.
Absolutely.
But I don't.
Yes.
It's your territory.
Nope. Just.
I know. I was going to wait and see. I didn't know if Senator Johnson wanted it, but if not, I would take it. That's good. All right. Okay. I was being selfish here. All right. With that, we will move to Senate Bill 42, which authorizes the Board of Regents to contract for the design and construction of an addition to the Wellness Center at the University of South Dakota to make an appropriation, therefore, and declare an emergency. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to speak on behalf of Senate Bill 42. Senate Bill 42 is an expansion to the Wellness Center on the University of South Dakota's campus, and being passed out now is a little bit more information about that, and I'll try to go through this very briefly so that we can stay on schedule. The Wellness Center at the University of South Dakota campus began its planning in 2008, and at that time determined that there needed to be three phases. The first phase was completed in 2011. This is phase two of three, and it adds the aquatic options to that Wellness Center for the students and the community. The initial phases, when we originally went through this process, phase two did not include a varsity swimming and diving option. We were going to build this facility without the athletics department utilizing this facility. What we discovered is that it could be far more efficient to have one aquatic location rather than two. Certainly also after 43 years, the pool in the dome was beginning to fail pretty significantly. It was costing us a great deal to maintain it, and keeping it chemically balanced was very difficult. And there wasn't a lot of opportunity for the community or student population in general to utilize that facility. So upon further evaluation, we decided that it made a lot of sense to have this one facility as opposed to do this just for the students at large, and then later come back and look at something for athletics. That's why we're in front of you today, because of that athletics component. So out of an abundance of caution, we are bringing this forward because it is new square footage, and it does involve a small academic component to it. I think some key points here are there are no state funding requested, not for construction, not for maintenance, not for utilities, and we're also not requesting a tuition and fee increase for our students. These dollars have been accumulated over time from the wellness activities, and these dollars will be reinvested for those students so that those students can benefit. As I mentioned earlier, this replaces a 43-year-old Dakota Dome pool. The expansion will add 47,000 square feet, as I mentioned before, and it will provide significant more opportunities for students and community members in Vermilion. Right now, there are very limited amounts of time, hours, blocks of time in the day for the general student population or the community, because as you can imagine, in a very small pool with 80 swim and dive student athletes, they can't all practice in that small pool at the same time. So swimming and diving is taking up all the time in the Dakota Dome pool, with the exception of an hour here or there. This will allow us to have the aquatic option available for the majority of students. The time, 90% will be available for students and community, whereas 10% will go to athletics. So that will make a big difference for student opportunities, community opportunities. The only thing I would add on that as well is that we would be allowed to host some competitions for our local community, vast Vermilion area swim team, and help drive a little bit of tourism to the community of Vermilion, as well as potentially prop up that economic development. These families come in, they stay all day for that meet, and they go into town, and they may fill up with gas, fill up their gas tanks, or eat a lunch or dinner or otherwise. So hopefully being able to partner with the city there and the community to drive a little bit of economic development. The estimated cost of this project is $25 million. It is funded by private and other funds. Those other funds, as I mentioned briefly, accumulated by the Wellness Center operations and memberships, and have proven to be very key in driving matching private gifts. The donors feel good about getting the power of $2 for everyone donated. And so at this moment, we're funding this at about half private, half other. Some of the qualitative impacts of adding this option for health and wellness for our students is that healthier students are better learners. You'll see in the handout here that increasing recreational activity by 1 hour per week increases the odds of persistence in graduation by 49%. That's substantial. And we didn't come with this project with just the 2008 student cohorts. We've also involved our current students, and this is very important to them as well. On January 18th, they passed a resolution unanimously in support of this project, and they would also ask for your support. In closing, I would just say that this adds increased opportunities for some new and aquatic programmings for both students and community members, to include water walking, paddleboard, yoga, water fitness classes, aquatic rehabilitation, aqua jogging, water volleyball, underwater hockey, which I don't know how that's going to be played. I'll be interested to see how that works. Intramural programming, underwater ninja obstacle course, and much more. We'll also be able to accommodate a lot more with swimming lessons for the local community, for the youth, and we'll be able to accommodate a lot more lap swim for our community and students at large. And as I mentioned earlier, hopefully enhancing the community tourism and their economy by partnering to put together some swim meets. There are not a lot of facilities like this in the area, and I think that this would be a real opportunity for Vermilion at large, as well as the University of South Dakota. So I would ask for your support of Senate Bill 42, and I will stand by for questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Further proponents of Senate Bill 42? Further proponents? Good morning and welcome back.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Brian Maher, Executive Director and CEO of the South Dakota Board of Regents. I'm here this morning to tell you that the board supports Senate Bill 42. However, you won't find it on our priority list, and that is because it doesn't require any general funds. There is no ask. All of the funding is done internally on this project. However, this is a board-approved project, and the project is making its way through our facilities process. So make no mistake, there is board approval for this. We urge your support of Senate Bill 42. Thank you.
Thank you. Further proponents to Senate Bill 42? Further proponents? Is there anybody online? No? Okay. Last call. Any further proponents? Are there any opponents? Any opponents? Seeing none, I will open this up for questions by the committee. Senator Johnson.
Thank you. So has the municipality been requested to get involved in this?
Madam Chair. Excellent question. The first phase, the community provided $340,000, and we are in conversation with them now and have been talking about the impact that this will have on a broader scale. The aquatics piece is much more significant. Our local chamber and development corporation has indicated support, and we are meeting with the local city council next month, I believe. But there's pretty good indication that they will support this. This has been a need and a desire for the community for a long time, and an alternative in some ways for them, because they had been looking at a community recreational center, and this will help solve a big piece of what they were hoping to solve. So very optimistic about their support.
So there's support specifically. There is financial support on the horizon from Vermilion.
Madam Chair. We anticipate there will be financial support in that private dollar amount from the city. Yes, thank you.
And finally, because I'm familiar with how Rapid City Parks and Recreation works with their swim center, how do you plan, or have you planned on assessing fees, user fees for this? Have you gone through that? Yeah.
Madam Chair. We do. We have a membership fee for all community members. The students obviously can use it without cost. However, we do have a fee structure for community members. We have day pass options, monthly options, or annual options. And that also will help pay for what we need for lifeguards. So,
Senator Nesba.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair and President Gestring. In terms of its cost to the state, will there be any ongoing M&R, any other expenses that the state's going to be, or that, that will fall to us, that we'll have to pay as a result of this building project?
Madam Chair, that's an excellent question. There will not. As I mentioned earlier, about 10% of this will be academic utilization, and that's when the state gets involved with M&R and utilities on the academic side. But with such an immaterial amount, we are planning to cover that through the auxiliary system and other funds. We will not come forward for general funds for this.
Happy to hear it. Senator Maher.
Madam Chair, the question I have is, tell a little bit logistic. You were talking about the pool in the dome. What happens upon completion of this building? What happens to that space within the dome, and who pays for the retrofitting and the upgrades then to the dome area?
Madam Chair.
What becomes of that space?
Yep. Madam Chair, that's an excellent question. What we will most likely end up doing is filling that pool or covering it in some way. It's not usable. It leaks quite significantly. Well, I shouldn't say it's not usable. We're using it now. It's just very difficult to keep it chemically balanced. Actually, in the past, I've had some situations where swimmers became ill because the chemicals became out of balance. But we will stop using that pool. And then part of our campus master plan will include some renovation of that east side underneath all the stadium chairs. We'll have to get a fundraising campaign going for that, though. But for the time being, we'll close it and cover it.
Go ahead. Then what becomes of that space? Once it's covered up, what's your intentions with that space?
Madam Chair. That will be determined through the master planning. If I were to try to predict the future, I suspect that will include some improved locker rooms for the Olympic sports. We've taken care of volleyball, basketball, football. We need to take care of the Olympic sports. Some of those lockers need significant improvements, particularly as we seek to continue to stay compliant with Title IX.
I have a few questions. Do you have currently a relationship with the hospital for aquatic therapy, and they utilize that for their patients, or?
Madam Chair, we do not at present. This will provide that opportunity. A competition pool, even the one in the dome, has to be kept at about 79 degrees, and it's very, very cold, not great for patient care. With this facility and the expansion, we will be reaching out to them to see if they find some need for that, because we'll have a rec pool that accompanies this. I think there's a real opportunity there.
Well, I'm going to dig deeper, because you have an OT and a PT school, so I would think some clinicals in aquatic therapy would be an opportunity that you're not currently having for that clinical side of practice.
Madam Chair, you're a mind reader. That's exactly what we're looking at right now.
All right. And then one other thing. Does Vermilion have any, physical fitness opportunities other than this for public access?
Madam Chair, I believe they have an anytime fitness. It's very limited cardio and weight, but nothing like the Wellness Center.
And what would you say currently with the business that you're doing with the community, how much of that, what's the percentage of that business of the private utilization versus students?
Madam Chair, we've had as many as nearly 1,000 members in the past. COVID really stopped a lot of people from coming to the Wellness Center, but we anticipate we'll be able to recapture that number and more with this aquatic facility option. A lot of times now families are going to the local Best Western to check out a pool for an hour or so at a time, and it's a very small hotel pool, so that option really doesn't exist for our community. We think this will drive more community involvement.
I see your finance person. I'm really drilling for numbers here, a percentage. On the business side, for that public, you know, you talked about memberships and that. What kind of numbers are we talking about? Because you also indicated that supports, you know, part of your operations.
Excuse me, Madam Chair. Jessica Preister, Assistant Vice President for the University of South Dakota of Finance. We currently, I'm trying to find my page, as of last fall, our current student membership count, 9,300 students, and our...
not all in Vermilion.
Correct, yes, not all in Vermilion, thank you. Students that have access to use a facility, and our... can't find my page, here we go. Our most recent count was 910 for community memberships.
One last thing, do you have any partnerships with Vermilion High School currently that utilize your Wellness Center for, you know, their sports, strength training, or anything?
Madam Chair, we haven't had anything formal with the Wellness Center specifically. We do have a formal arrangement with them for use of the arena, use of the dome, use of Slagle Hall. Certainly, we leave all kinds of options open for them when they make a request, and if they would need something, we would accommodate.
Any other questions? Seeing none, thank you, and I will close this hearing to public testimony and open it up for discussion and or action.
Madam Chair.
Senator Johnson.
I would move due pass on Senate Bill 42.
It's been moved by Senator Johnson, seconded by Senator Greenfield for due pass on Senate Bill 42. Comments on that motion?
I can restrict my comments to the fact that, well, since it is my alma mater, one of the two, I would like to really congratulate him for extending a hand to the community, to the local education community and the municipality. This really impresses me with the planning and the foresight that they've got to serve both the community and the campus. So this is a very good idea.
Thank you. Anything else? Hearing none, the motion before is due pass on Senate Bill 42. Those in favor of say aye, those opposed nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Greenfield.
Aye.
Johnson.
Aye.
Kolbeck.
Aye.
Maher.
Aye.
Nesba.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Wick.
Aye.
Breitling.
Aye.
And Hunhoff.
Aye. By majority vote, it is due pass on Senate Bill 42 from this committee. Now, is Senator Johnson the only alumnus from USD? All right.
He's got to give a swimming
lesson. What? No, from here, on this committee to take the bill to the floor. I'm giving you that opportunity.
I'm honored.
All right. That's what I want. I just want to know if there was any other coyote on this team.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I would hope that the senator would use such puns as take a deeper dive and trying to tread water.
I was going to follow up on it. There's a lot of coyotes on this committee.
Well, I want to thank all of you that came today to testify on your bills. More importantly, I thank you for respecting time. I think we had fair hearings. We got the questions asked. So I thank you very much. And I think, committee, we are just going to recess because we're going to come back after session.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I believe we have a separate agenda that's been printed, and if we adjourn, we can get our committee report in.
Oh, all right. Thank you for that. So
I'll move to adjourn.
Second.
Okay, moved by Senator Greenfield, seconded by Senator Wick. All those in favor of adjourning signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. We are adjourned.
Joint Committee on Appropriations will come to order. Madam Secretary, will you call the roll, please?
Senators and Representatives Gross.
Here.
Fitzgerald.
Here.
Duba.
Here.
Wick.
Absent excused.
Haugard.
Absent excused.
Nisba.
Absent excused.
Johnson.
Absent excused.
May.
Here.
Mills.
Here.
Maher.
Here.
Mullally.
Here.
Colbeck. Sutton.
Here.
Greenfield.
Here.
Breitling.
Absent excused.
Howard.
Here.
Hunhoff.
Here.
And Carr.
Here. Breitling just walked in as well.
We do have a quorum.
We have a quorum. Thank you. We're going to start this morning with the Pledge of Allegiance. Senator Maher, will you lead us, please? Everybody stand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Everybody said it.
Thank you, Senator Maher. Are we to have a tally going? Oh. I believe your name's on there. It's your flag. You can move it if you'd like. All right. Do we have any minutes? Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I move that we approve the minutes of Tuesday, February 15th.
I have a motion by Representative Mills to approve the minutes from February 15th, seconded by Senator Greenfield. Comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This was the day we had the revenue projections and adopted those projections. So,
any other comments? Seeing none, this is a voice vote. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. That motion passes. Thank you. Any additional minutes? Okay, this morning, the Joint Committee has a bill hearing agenda for the following bills: HB 1013, HB 1018, HB 1019, and HB 1020. We will take them in that order. And we will start with HB 1013, to make an appropriation for certain costs related to Capitol Lake and to declare an emergency. Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. If I could have pages distributed.
Please, yep.
While they're doing that, good morning, Mr. Chairman. Scott Bollinger, Bureau of Administration, asking for your favorable consideration on House Bill 1013. I'll give it a moment just so they can get those passed out.
Thank you very much.
I will comment, Mr. Chair. I took to heart Representative Mills' comments at our budget hearing of being visual, and this is one of the visual things to help folks understand what the gravity of what we're doing.
We've been looking at Google map images all morning, so in-house.
Okay. I think we have the items distributed. If you want to proceed, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, Scott Ballinger, Bureau of Administration. The handouts you have are, one is a one-page summary of kind of describes what House Bill 1013 does. The second one is kind of an overhead visual using Google Earth that kind of shows you what our intentions are in terms of where the water would come from. Come up Capitol Creek, we pump fresh water into the lake, and that's the red line. And the yellow line, and I didn't put one over the lake, but the lake would be dredged. And also, as you see Capitol Creek, all the way up to 4th Street, which is where the health lab is, for those of you familiar with where the health lab is. We would start on the north end and work from 4th Street south as we work towards the lake, because anything happens rainwater-wise will carry everything into the lake, so it doesn't make sense to dredge the lake first. We'll start on the north end, and then we would also look at starting the pipeline from the Missouri at the same time. What it requires us to do eventually is drain the lake itself, and hopefully it'll have it dry out a little bit to make it less sloppy to get that material out of there. But for those of you that remember, I think this was done like 30 years ago, so it's been quite a while since that the lake has been dredged. And so by virtue of dredging it, we get additional water capacity. What our long-term hope is to be able to pump water from the Missouri into the lake and then feed our irrigation systems around the campus with the fresh water from the Missouri rather than treated water from the city, which will save us money long term. And in discussions with the city briefly, without going into a lot of detail with them, this actually extends the life of their water treatment plant as well, so it benefits them as well. We plan to talk to the city, we plan to talk to the school district to see if they have any interest in adjacent properties as we come up the creek, if there's properties that would benefit them that we could pump water, and then they use their ARPA money to take care of their component of that. But we've not had those discussions at this point, and that would be their money, not it wouldn't be funneled through us. So we're not asking for any expenditure authority for their funds. With that, Mr. Chairman, I'll stand by for any questions the committee may have at this point.
We're going to hold questions till the end if you can stick around.
Okay.
And we'll continue through testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Request your favorable support.
Any further proponent testimony? Do we have any additional proponent testimony? Seeing none, any opponent testimony? Do we have any opponent testimony? Last chance. Seeing no opponent testimony, we will move into committee questions and or comments. Questions from the committee. Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Question for Mr. Ballinger. I think, sir, when we had this preliminary hearing on this issue, we had some people here in the room that aren't here today, but they were promoting a different solution that would involve refurbishing the underground well that would allow the flame to be a part of the project. Is that off the table or still under consideration as an option? What's the status of that?
Mr. Chairman?
Please.
Representative Mills, I'm certainly not an expert in when it comes to water, and I do have somebody from DENR could get into the specifics if you want. But understand that if we continue with the existing water source as it is, we will not qualify under the ARPA because it doesn't clean up the water. We're going to get the same water we had before. So we would have to take that component of it to redo the well and put general funds in to do that piece, which would be over $1 million.
Follow up.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So you're saying because of the funding source, that particular idea is off the table?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
I wouldn't say it, Representative Mills, I wouldn't say it's off the table. I mean, for us, we're looking at the available resources and how can we do this to last for the next 30 years or so. Ideally, pumping the water from the aquifer is truly a waste of water from the aquifer itself. The quality of the water is not desirable. Yes, it comes up warm and it does keep part of the lake open, which invites our friends from the north to stick around longer, this year being an exception. But what I would tell you is, in the long term for the benefit of natural resources and so on, it makes more sense to pump water in up from the Missouri, and any excess will go right back to the Missouri.
Follow up.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So is the intention, if you are to move forward with the pumping the water up from the Missouri, would the intention be to shut that off in the wintertime?
Mr. Chairman, because of the temperature of the water, yes, we'd have to shut it off at some point in October, November, depending on the weather. But we'd make sure that the lake was full before we did that, and so we'd have water resources there.
Okay. Senator Maher.
The question I have, Mr. Chair, is how in the world did you get approval from the Corps of Engineers to go forward with this? I can't believe they just let you pump water out of the Missouri River without going through years and years and years of work with the Corps, let alone and then to discharge back into the Missouri River. That's got to take a substantial amount of approval.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to phone a friend and ask somebody from DNR Gene Goodman's here from DNR, could probably address that better than me.
Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Gene Goodman. I'm the Deputy Secretary of the Department of Agriculture and Natural Resources. And Chairman, if I may answer
please.
The question.
Go ahead.
Senator, the state of South Dakota has the authority to issue a water right out of the Missouri River. We can use that water. The city, in my knowledge, the city has worked with the Corps and has obtained water rights at different points and does have the authority to access the Missouri River and put diversion points in the Missouri River. And this would be one point that they could. So if the state chose to do that or the city chose to do that, we could obtain a water right from the water rights program in my department. And the Corps would not be able to stop that. It is our authority, it's our water to appropriate. The discharge, I'm sorry if I might answer that question as well. The discharge, I would not anticipate a lot of discharge that would be coming from this particular, if this would go through, that we could manage the water to a point where there should not be any discharge other than what's naturally coming through the creek.
Senator Maher, Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I believe it was mentioned that one of the benefits of this pumping up from the Missouri would be to provide for the irrigation for the campus, if you will. Is that correct?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
Representative Mills, that's correct. We have not, we want to get the core pieces done, get the water pumped up, get the lake dredged, the creek dredged, get the well taken care of. And then once that's done, determine what we need to do for piping to do the additional irrigation to connect to our existing systems. We just need to get the water to a pump source.
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
Follow up. Thank you. So the pump, the pipe and the pump and everything up from the Missouri would be covered under the, as you understand it, the ARPA funding?
Mr. Chairman.
Yep.
That would be correct.
Follow up. Would there be any thought to maybe doing that component of the project using the ARPA funding, but then also potentially resurrecting the existing artesian well?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
I'm not sure I follow your question, Representative Mills.
Well, I'm wondering if it's an either or. I mean, you know, if there isn't some methodology that would combine the two, you know, we could bring the water up using the ARPA funding to accommodate the irrigation component, but then in terms of keeping the lake full and having all of that benefit that South Dakota's enjoyed for decades, you know, to using the upgrading the artesian well so that it could still have the flame. And I'm just wondering if those two components could, if there's any potential they could both happen.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
I guess I would go back to my previous comments that if we go the route of rehabbing the well, it would not qualify under ARPA, and then we would have to significantly change this bill to come in asking for general funds to do the well restoration.
follow up. Is there any estimate to just do the well restoration? Do we have an estimated cost for that?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
It's somewhere in the range of $750,000 to $1 million.
Okay, I think we have some other questions. Just want to clarify, make sure I understand. I know you've kind of touched on these things. The $3.5 million that we're talking about addresses, I'm looking at this Google map, to dredge this creek out, as well as bring the water up from the river. Okay. And then...
And dredge the lake, Mr. Chairman.
And dredge the lake, thank you. What about the flame? We had some testimony about the flame and its importance and, you know, using gas or some other source. Does this plan address the flame component?
Mr. Chairman, I will tell you that what we envision is plugging the well, as I was corrected during our budget hearing. It's our intent to close that off, which would negate the natural gas that came from the aquifer out of it. The opportunity to put a gas flame exists, but we're looking at an annual cost of $50,000 to $75,000 for natural gas to keep it lit 24/7.
So the current plan would be to no flame with what we got here.
Mr. Chairman, what I would tell you today, and I had a conversation with one of the legislators last night, is the vision for this whole area is we want to address the water issues first. And then the $500,000 of general funds that's involved in this project is really will be a culmination of working with the veterans groups, working with Native American groups, working with tourism and chamber groups locally to determine what should this footprint look like going forward that will benefit South Dakotans and any other guests that want to come to spend time around the lake. And so for me to say there is a flame or isn't a flame, that's undetermined at this point on what that would look like. Is it a consideration? Absolutely. One of the other pieces that will be part of the consideration when we look at designing what's next. I know you have a bill that's a Code Talker Memorial that was approved back in 2016, I believe. I think there's a newer version of it that is being considered. That would be considered as part of the footprint, and where do we put that? Is if we change something, does it make more sense for it to be here, or should it be here? Kind of thing, and work with those various constituent groups to make that designation. And then we would come back to you next session to say, okay, based upon the input from all those groups, here's what our plan is, here's what it's going to cost, and go from there.
Other questions from the committee? No?
Mr. Chair.
Representative Gross, then Representative Mullally.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. To clarify for me, if you would, please, and I have in the back of my mind from a couple weeks ago when you presented some of this, is that the dredging of the creek, is that strictly to dredge a creek, or is there any Missouri River water going to end up on the upper elevation of that creek and have fresh water flowing back into the lake?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
My understanding is Capitol Creek, other than natural rainfall, there is a spring fed that feeds that creek on a limited basis. So that would be the freshwater source. We're not intending to pump Missouri River water up to fill those. We're hoping that we can work. One of the side projects I talked to you about is DOT is looking at redoing Euclid Avenue, which is the highway coming in from the north. Well, part of that is looking at dealing with the stormwater runoff. And there are two components of that stormwater runoff that come in from the northwest corner on your map up on 4th Street. And there's another piece that actually comes under Governor's Grove in Hildreth Gulch. For those of you familiar with where Governor's Grove is, their initial proposal was to take a 24-inch pipe and do a 36-inch pipe for stormwater runoff. And they suggested they were going to come right through the middle of Governor's Grove, which I said, no. But we're looking at branching that off and bringing it out around Governor's Grove and drain into Capitol Creek, which would provide additional natural source water in that area. But when we dredge the creek, one of the things we're looking at is, can we create retention ponds to hold more water that we could pump out of, as opposed to pulling it from the Missouri? It'd be less costly.
Follow up.
Go ahead.
When you say hold more water, hold more natural water, not Missouri River water, but natural.
Mr. Chairman.
Natural drainage into those.
That would be correct.
Thank you very much.
Representative Mullally.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just following up on Representative Gross's line of thinking, in dredging this creek, it's basically a stormwater creek. Is that it's not an actual creek that runs all the time? Is that my understanding?
Mr. Chairman,
go ahead.
Representative Mullally, I will tell you that in times like it is today, there isn't a whole lot of water in there. But under normal years with normal rainfall, there's typically water in there. But for those of you that pay attention to the Gulch, if you spend any time in the Gulch, since my time in BOA, which is now almost 6 years, the amount of rushes and reeds has more than doubled because the siltation continues to fill it in. And so the water that does come through, most of the silt stays in the Gulch, and it's continuing to erode the natural grasslands that are around it. And so our intent is to dig it deeper and hopefully create retention ponds so it'll hold the water so we can irrigate directly from there.
A follow-up.
Go ahead.
So in dredging this, knowing that the silt is built up, is there any chance of the silt getting to the lake to cause build up a silt there and possible grass growth that, you know, like slough grasses?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
The answer, the easy answer to your question is yes. I mean, any water flow that comes through Capitol Creek will eventually dump some silt into Capitol Lake. And so the fact that it hasn't been done in 30 years, there's a lot of silt material, not to mention our friends' deposits that visit us every year. And so it's at a point in time where both need to be cleaned out for the long haul, and then hopefully we won't have to do it again for another 25 or 30 years.
Any additional committee questions? Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm just kind of going back to the ARPA funds and what they can be used for. So we want $500,000 from the general fund, so we don't have any stipulations there, but to appropriate the sum of $3 million in federal fund expenditure authority. So can you, I mean, I'm looking at the project descriptions. So under the ARPA funds, capping the existing well, is that under the ARPA funds?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
That would be correct.
Okay, follow up. Okay, so if we decided not to cap it and to fix it, would that fall under the ARPA funds?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
As I've stated before, if we choose to rehab the well, that would not qualify under the ARPA funds. We would have to appropriate general funds to do that component.
Follow up.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. It just seems a little confusing that one way it's covered, the other way it's not. We're still dealing with an existing well. So under the ARPA funding, and I'm sorry, I don't know this, the only way that it can be paid for is if it is capped.
Mr. Chairman? That would be correct, and maybe I can put it in the context of the quality of the water that's coming out of the aquifer today is not good quality water, but by virtue of bringing Missouri River water, we improve the quality of the water, and therefore it falls under the clean water component of the ARPA funding.
Follow up.
Go ahead.
Okay, so let's go to the water thing. When you talk about quality of water for who? The geese or the grass?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
We're talking about the quality of water that comes out of the aquifer. It doesn't matter who it's for, but the fact that we're allowing it to be released from the aquifer above ground affects the water quality of the lake as well as what goes down to the Missouri. And so the fact that the water of the quality is less than desirable, the quality of the water coming, pumping it up from the Missouri is much better than what's coming out of the ground.
Follow up.
Go ahead.
So that is a requirement under the ARPA funds, that the water quality has to be better than what it is now. Is that correct?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
I know there's multiple areas under ARPA in terms, but this specifically falls under the Clean Water Act component.
Follow up. The Clean Water Act, is that under the ARPA?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
I think if we want to dig in the weeds, I'd ask Deputy Secretary Goodman maybe to explain maybe in more detail to get into those specifics, if you want to dig into those specifics.
Follow up. I'm just curious. Are we looking at all ARPA funds here, or are we looking at funds outside of the ARPA, specifically the clean water?
Mr. Chairman,
go ahead.
We're not looking at Clean Water Act funding. This is ARPA funds, but some of the requirements under the ARPA usage is, does it improve the quality of water? Does it deal with wastewater? Does it deal with stormwater runoff? Those kinds of things. It just so happens this component falls under the category of clean water that's approved under ARPA to do projects.
Thank you.
Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I believe we had a presentation about zebra mussels. Are they present in the Missouri River or Lake Sharp or whatever it is at this point? Do you know?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
Sorry, I can't help you on that one.
Okay.
That'd be a Game Fish and Parks question. I don't know the answer to that.
Follow up.
Thank you. I understand they're very problematic with pumps and wells and things like that, and that's what we'd be talking about installing. And so I just, you know, was wondering if there'd been any consideration about the impact if we go this route that the zebra mussels might have on that new equipment and shortening the life of it and, you know, adding to the cost of maintaining and all that kind of thing. So I was curious.
Any other questions from the committee? Any committee questions? Representative Haugard.
Yes, just kind of a follow-up to that. Maybe you're not aware of this one either. It might be a GF&P thing, but when that material's dredged out, where would that end up being placed? Is that going to be deposited on farm ground around here, or what's the plan?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
I'd probably refer to Deputy Secretary Goodman in terms of what they've looked at, but we will have discussions with the city because it'll come out fairly wet and not real usable. It'll have to be stored until it can be dried, but I think at some point it could, either one, if it's good enough quality, I could use it for soil and patching and whatever else around state camp grounds, or we could declare it surplus and sell it to people who want it. I mean, that's an option available to us. We've had preliminary talks with the city, not in great detail because we haven't talked about what the volume is, but just to give people an idea of the volume of material, if you look at the north end of the gulch where the two soccer fields are, the material that is there came from the dredging the first time.
Okay.
So you're talking a lot of material. And so we're going to have to look at between the city and existing state properties around the city of Pier, where do we move it and temporarily store it or let it dry out or whatever the case may be. It might be an opportunity for the city landfill that this would give them additional material they could use when an area gets full, they need topsoil material. It may work out in our favor to work with the city in that regard, but we've not gotten that far along in the discussions.
So the costs that we're looking at, they don't include dealing with this material, storing it, like you said, or dealing with it. Are there going to be additional costs then?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
The only cost we would have is removal and to a storage site. We would either pick some state property so we're not paying rent or anything to place it there. And if we can work it out with the city where it benefits them and they have a site we can deliver it to, then we would look at that as an option as well.
But the cost for that component would not be included in what we're looking at here today. So there'll be some sort of additional cost, and that's covered by...
Mr. Chairman, I would not anticipate there's additional cost just to have it sit on the ground. Because if we work some out with the city where they get some benefit out of it, I wouldn't anticipate them charging us to use vacant land to do that, or we have some vacant properties we could store some material. We just don't know if we have enough room to do it all.
Okay. Any other committee questions? Representative Mullally?
Mr. Chair, thank you. More of a comment just on that line of thought. The West Dakota Water Development District had allowed Canyon Lake here in West Rapid City to dredge there. Lake, you might want to because they left it right there at the lake for it to dry. And then just, if you want to realize what they did, might be best practices for you as well to check into that.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Representative Mullally. I'm sure that DNR probably has familiarity with that project. One of the things, you know, and this is very simplistic from my standpoint, is if you look behind the health lab up on 4th Street on your map, there's actually some side hill area that's vacant. And they make these, what I would call a seine tube, that you could pump that material in. So the water comes back, but the material stays in the tube and let it sit there for a year, 2 years, whatever it takes to dry it out. And then we'd be able to leave it there in the event we need to move it. But I think we just have to be smart enough when we do start moving it that we don't leave it open and it can drain right back into the creek itself.
Any other questions from the committee? Seeing none, we're going to close the question component. We'll move into action and or discussion. Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll move do pass.
Second. A motion by Senator Greenfield, do pass. Seconded by Representative Howard. Comments on that motion?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I view this as a necessity. This has to be done. What happens relative to the flame and whatnot going forward? I guess that remains subject to debate. But if we just keep our eye on the fact that we have a responsibility and we can clean things up, I think this is appropriate, and I would ask for your support. Thank you.
Any other comments? Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm really thankful that there's a master plan, and I want to be supportive of that. I do, however, have some real concerns with maybe short-sighted thinking in regard to this particular component. I would just share briefly that when I was a kid, I remember coming on a family vacation to the Black Hills and stopping at Pier. And I was young and I didn't care much about Capitol buildings, but that flaming fountain just stuck with me. And how does that happen? I think we may be losing sight of what kind of an iconic feature that is and how much of a draw it is, and its particular significance. And we heard that in testimony from the veterans about that fountain and the flame. And I'm not in favor of paying $50,000 or $75,000 to bring in a natural gas line and burn that when we can tap that resource that's there like we have for decades. And I had a good conversation with Mr. Moisen, I believe, afterward, and he understands very well how that refurbishing could be done and feels like it would be last a long, long time. And so I'm grateful they have a master plan. I want to see that part continue. I think if we fund it now, they're going to go forward with what I believe is a not fully thought out plan. We also heard about the fact they haven't given any thought to the zebra mussels and the impact on pumps. And so I'm going to oppose this motion.
Other comments?
Mr. Chair.
Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And just kind of what Representative Mills, I mean, we all know, I think, that something needs to be done there. We need to clean it up and things need to be done. But, you know, we heard so many concerns from the veterans and then former Senator or Representative Rounds. You know, the flame is an important component of that lake, and we just can't get around that. I mean, I know countless people, they come to Pier for some things, but it's not shopping, it's not coming to the Capitol, it's going and looking at the flame over the years. So I'm a little disappointed that this, you know, there hasn't been more insight into that part of it. And so I, too, will be opposing this.
Other comments? Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The flame flamed out a while back, and so it hasn't been the attraction for a while. I'm not saying, I absolutely agree, and I made my case earlier today with some of my colleagues that I very much would like to see the flame restored. But killing this bill doesn't do anything. If you keep the bill alive, we can continue the discussion. If we kill the bill, it's off the table. So I would, again, encourage your support. Thank you.
Any other comments from the committee? Okay. Seeing none, Madam Secretary, call the roll, please.
Senators and representatives, Gross.
Aye.
Fitzgerald.
Juba. No.
Aye.
Wick.
Aye.
Hogard.
Aye.
Nisba.
Okay.
Johnson.
Aye.
May.
No, no.
Mills.
Nay.
Maher.
Aye.
Mullally.
No.
Colbeck.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Greenfield.
Aye.
Breitling.
Aye.
Howard.
Aye.
Hunhoff.
Aye.
And Carr.
Aye.
13 yeas, 4 nays, 1 excused.
That motion receiving a majority of the members does pass. We're going to move to HB 1018, make an appropriation for the construction of a storage garage in Rapid City and to declare an emergency. Come on up. Good morning. Do you have any handouts or anything that you'd like us to look at?
Good morning, Mr. Chair. I do not.
That's fine. That's fine. You go ahead and state your name and you may proceed.
Mr. Chair and committee members, good morning. My name is Jason Ketterling. I'm the Assistant Superintendent for the South Dakota Highway Patrol. On behalf of the Department of Public Safety, we bring House Bill 1018 forward. House Bill 1018 appropriates $557,300 in other funds, expenditure authority to the Department of Public Safety to build a garage onto the Highway Patrol office in Rapid City that sits adjacent to the Department of Transportation property off of exit 61 on I-90 there. The current building that the Highway Patrol is in District 3 serves as a district office in Rapid City. That building was constructed in 2015. The previous building prior to that did have a storage garage nearby that was utilized by our department. Due to some budget constraints, we did not request additional funding in 2015 for the construction of a garage. That space, if considered in House Bill 1018, would allow for the removal of drug and other evidence that is currently stored inside of the district office in Rapid City. The area would also provide additional secure areas to conduct vehicle searches and other criminal investigations that involve motor vehicles. Currently, our troopers are searching vehicles at the adjacent Department of Transportation maintenance bay areas. Although it is secure at times, we are utilizing other state employees' workspace as well in order to make that happen. In addition, technical crash reconstructions and examination of these vehicles could also be conducted indoors right at the Highway Patrol office in Rapid City. Currently, those investigation practices are either done outside or at some other agency's indoor facilities. A garage on site would also allow Highway Patrol equipment currently located in off-site storage locations and ultimately allow us to better utilize our personnel and be more efficient too. Initial size of the garage storage space is estimated to be about 2,000 square feet and directly attached to the office. That construction would include 4 overhead garage doors, and As some of you may or may not know, our Highway Patrol office in Rapid City is also utilized for part of the motorcycle safety training that's conducted. On the north side of the building is a driver training area that's on the asphalt. In addition to that, our office also serves as a classroom style presentation area, so those classroom instruction can take place inside of the district office, and then the students just walk around the building, get on their motorcycles, and do some practical training just on the north side of the building. Motorcycle safety currently houses motorcycles inside of a Connex container. For those that don't know what a Connex container, it is basically a shipping container that is sitting outside on the north side of the office area. So those motorcycles are stored inside of there. As part of House Bill 1018, we would actually utilize one of the stalls of the garage area and actually get those motorcycles inside of the garage area, and thus they wouldn't have any more need for the Connex container outside as well. So all of those, I just would ask that you favorable support for House Bill 1018. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ketterling. Any further proponent testimony? Any further proponent testimony? Any further proponent? Seeing none, any opponent testimony? Any opponent testimony? Seeing none, we'll move into committee questions and or comments. Questions from the committee. No? Okay, seeing no questions, we'll move into action or discussion.
I would move that we pass HB 1018.
Second.
I have a motion by Representative Fitzgerald to pass, seconded by Senator Wick. Any further comments on that motion?
I think an excellent explanation was given. I don't think it's anything that we shouldn't support. So I would just ask everyone to please vote yes.
Additional comments on the motion? Senator Wick.
Well, Mr. Chair, I do believe we should keep very close eye on our highway funds, as you know, there's this constant watch over what the state of our highways are going to be like. But this is, when the highway fund was set up, this is qualified use of those funds. And since the Highway Patrol gets a significant portion of the highway funds for their operations, and this does make their operations more efficient, I believe it is a good use of these funds, and we should move forward with the project and support this bill. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Any other comments on the motion? Seeing none, the motions do pass by Representative Fitzgerald, seconded by Senator Wick. Madam Secretary, call the roll, please.
Senators and Representatives Gross.
Aye.
Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Duba.
Aye.
Wick.
Aye.
Haugard.
Absent excused.
Nesba.
Absent excused.
May. Excuse me, Johnson.
Aye.
May.
Aye.
Mills.
Aye.
Maher. Mullally.
Aye.
Colbeck.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Greenfield.
Aye.
Breitling.
Aye.
Howard.
Aye.
Hunoff.
Aye.
And Carr.
Aye.
16-2.
That motion, receiving a majority votes of the members here, does pass. We'll move into HB 1019, make an appropriation for the payment of extraordinary litigation expenses and to declare an emergency. Welcome back.
Good morning again, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Scott Ballinger, Bureau of Administration. I have for you House Bill 1019. It's the Extraordinary Litigation Fund, or as we nicely call it, ELF, for easy purposes. This is something that we brought this bill for at least as long as I've been here, dating back to 2016. It's been an annual appropriation. we provided previously during our budget hearing a four-page document. We did notice that the document that's on your budget notes and so on only had the two front pages. It didn't have the two back pages. And I gave a copy to Senator Hunhoff, and I don't know if they've gotten it updated on the system yet or not. But I will tell you today the Extraordinary Litigation Fund is just over $400,000 in the hole. We continue to work through the various litigation pieces that we have. And for those of you that have been around legal things, they happen when they happen, and sometimes they take time to get done. But this is our projection for year end that we will be $1.5 million in the hole. And I do want to publicly correct from our budget hearing, and I let Senator Hunhoff know some time ago, we talked about the section of the law that deals with the life protection subfund, and we had talked about somebody donating $500,000. That was not correct on my part, that never happened. We went back in the record books, and the first deposit that was made into that fund was in 2006, and there were a handful of deposits in between now and then, and the current status of that fund is roughly just over $82,500 is sitting in that component of the fund. And so I did want to correct that for the committee's benefit. This is something we deal with when we get sued. We have to defend the state, and this is where these kinds of activities are funded. And it's a backfill similar to the Emergency and Disaster Fund, the Wildland Fire Fund, and those kinds of things. So with that, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate your support, and we'll stand by for questions.
Okay. We'll take questions at the end of testimony. Any other public testimony? Any proponent testimony? Any proponent testimony? Seeing none, any opponent testimony? Any opponent testimony? Seeing none, we're going to close testimony, move into questions. Questions from the committee or comments? Questions or comments? Seeing none, we'll move into action discussion.
Mr. Chair.
Senator Wick.
I would move due pass on House Bill 1090.
Second.
We have a motion due pass by Senator Wick, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald. Comments?
Mr. Chair. It's never fun to be sued, but when you're a state, it's going to happen. And I think we do a pretty good job of trying to avoid lawsuits, but some of the bills we pass, some of the things we do, and it's just a common piece of doing business today. So with that, I would urge us to support this, as the fund is already currently negative. And this is one of the few backfills that we deal with on a regular basis, and hope we can get the support of the committee. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Any other comments on the motion? Seeing no other comments on the motion, motion again is due pass by Senator Wick, second by Representative Fitzgerald. Madam Secretary, will you call the roll?
Senators and Representatives Gross?
Aye.
Fitzgerald?
Aye.
Duba?
Aye.
Wick?
Aye.
Haugard?
Aye.
Nesba? Johnson?
Aye.
May?
Aye.
Mills?
Aye.
Maher?
Aye.
Mullally?
Aye.
Senator Kolbeck?
Aye.
Sutton?
Aye.
Greenfield?
Aye.
Breitling?
Aye.
Howard?
Aye.
Hunhoff?
Aye.
And Carr?
Aye.
17 yeas, 1 excused.
That motion receiving a majority vote of the members does pass. We will move to the last bill on our agenda, HB 1020, authorize the Bureau of Administration to construct an addition to the Kinsman Building and Pier to make an appropriation, therefor, and to declare an emergency. Good morning and welcome.
Chairman Carr, members of the committee, great to be here. Andy Gerlach, Deputy Commissioner of Administration, and I will speak to House Bill 1020 this morning. I have a handout for you with some references and graphics, and as I go through my testimony, you can see visually what we're trying to do here. To give the committee some background, the Bureau of Administration Buildings and Grounds is responsible for the maintenance of the state capitol complex, buildings, grounds, as well as the remodeling and renovation of our buildings and custodial service. And I think we all appreciate the professionalism that they do. The division is organized into four sections, administration, trades, grounds, custodial. Virtually all of these sections take place, and the work that they do is around the Capitol complex here. During the 2012 legislative session, funding was appropriated for a maintenance shop that was constructed in the northwest corner of the DOT Becker Hansen parking lot. That's come to be known as the Kinsman Building. I'd like to share 4 points with you this morning why we're asking for an addition to the Kinsman Building. The first of which is to consolidate buildings and grounds into one location. We're currently located in three areas around Pier, the state capitol in the basement. We have our administrative staff and some of our custodial staff there. The National Guard Museum basement, located in downtown Pier, approximately 1 mile from the capitol. 21 staff, that's where our trades, carpenters, electricians are located. And then the state maintenance shop located on the truck bypass about 2 miles from the capitol, across the Walmart parking lot, has 13 staff. This is our ground staff that comes to work every day here on the capitol, mows the grass, shovels the snow in the winter, and they have to travel 2 miles to get here each day, and that's where they report to work. So we think that the consolidation of all of this group will promote some efficiencies of operation. They'll be located closer to their customers, respond to work orders and emergencies more timely. And then we can also, if we construct this, store our supplies in this facility and have a better opportunity for inventory control. Obviously, when we looked at this, we looked at cost savings too. The National Guard Museum, State Maintenance Shop, where they report each day, are away from the state capitol, resulting in numerous trips to and from these locations to do work orders and customer service. We estimate the Kinsman addition will drastically reduce travel time each day. Finally, safety. Current travel patterns to and from the capitol do offer greater risk. When you look at where the ground staff travels to, they go down 4th Street, and in the mornings when people are going to work, a lot more activity there. Trade staff coming from downtown Pier. We have had accidents in the past there that we've had to pay for. So safety is obviously a benefit to this as well. Included in the addition is the following. Currently, we occupy 25,150 square feet in these locations to include the Kinsman Building. Under this proposal, we would expand total footprint to 27,300 feet. This would allow for our larger equipment to be stored inside year-round. I think this will support the longevity of that and also save there. All HVAC, plumbing, electrical, carpentry, custodial equipment will also be stored inside. And as I stated earlier, we'll be able to purchase inventory, keep it on hand just in time, and I think we'll see a cost savings with that as well. To fund this project, we're asking the committee to support a $1,450,000 appropriation. This is two different funding sources, all other funds. The intent is to have it built by a contractor, but the fact that we do have talented staff, we can finish it off inside. That will allow us to save money there and have an overall cost saving. So building construction, we're estimating $995,000. Contractor cost, taxes, contingency, $355,000, and then $100,000 for the architectural design. To fund this, we will sell our state maintenance shop on Garfield, where our ground staff is, to the Department of Transportation. Sale proceeds bringing $368,000, and then the remaining $1,082,000 will be funded out of the Capitol Complex Maintenance and Repair Fund. So, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, we really think that this is a good project. It'll promote efficiency, customer service, and then we will ask, we will ask you to support this. And this makes a lot of sense and really allows our buildings and grounds staff to have a facility that's befitting of their operation. So with that, I will conclude my testimony. Ask for your support on House Bill 1020. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gerlach. Further proponents? Further proponents? Are there any opponents? Any opponents? Seeing none, I'll open up the committee for questions. Representative Mills.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Gerlach, I'm just looking at the estimate. I see architectural design for $100,000. I know that the Office of the State Engineer added an architect onto the staff, I think, recently. I was just curious if this would be for outside architecture or would this be a project that our own OSE engineer architect could design?
Madam Chair, Representative Mills, it's a great point. When we put this together, it was for an outside architect. The fact that we do have someone of that quality on board now could help with that as well.
Follow up. So at this point, that has not been explored, but that would be in conversation as you move forward?
Correct.
Madam Chair, follow up. Did the estimate that you have, was that prepared by the state engineer's office, or who came up with the cost numbers?
So Mills, yes, it was prepared by the state engineer's office.
Is that recent enough that we have some confidence in the numbers with all the inflation and everything we're dealing with, and considering the timeline to build out this, to design and build this project?
Representative Mills, that's a very good and timely question. As you know, with all the projects that we're seeing, we're seeing inflationary costs, steel materials. This estimate was put together before that. As we go along, we'll have to factor that in. I think looking internally, if we could save some cost with inflation, it would be good. We definitely want to keep at the amount that we're asking for an appropriation. So as we go forward and with some of the uncertainties out there with buildings, building projects, as you well know, we're going to want to keep this on budget and within the appropriation.
Madam Chair, follow-up. In the handout, there's a picture of a maintenance garage that was built back there. Is that maintenance garage incorporated into the new building as a component, and the new building would be added on to that, or how do they fit together?
I'm sure. If you would look at that picture, that is the Kinsman building as it stands right now. Within my handout, there's also a picture of a design to where what we think this could look like. If you look at the first four bays on the left-hand side, that's the current Kinsman building.
Right.
The rest of it would be the new build.
That's what I was assuming, and just wanted some confirmation since it doesn't tell me that. So thank you.
Further questions? Senator Wick.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I guess whoever can answer this one. The Appropriations Committee over the last couple of years has asked BOA to work on a plan for the Capitol complex. Is this part of the ideas that came out of that for better use of our square footage within the Capitol complex?
Madam Chair, Senator Wick, it absolutely is. If you look at our plan that we talked about in our Appropriations Committee hearing, if you look at it online, part of it has to do with making better use of the Capitol. The fact that buildings and grounds is actually in the basement of the Capitol will allow us to do that. This was one of the key components in our long-term strategic space plan.
I have a question. Oh, Senator Johnson, go ahead.
So you mentioned the Department of Transportation is involved with the acquiring the building up there by Walmart. It looks like. So has that a price already been agreed upon by the two departments, and what is the intent of DOT? What will they be using it for?
Madam Chair, Senator Johnson, yes, it is. We had an estimate done on the property. It came out to that. We have agreed with a price with the DOT. They actually have an individual that works in that shop too. They will stay there, and DOT will then become the owners of that property.
So did I hear then that they've already, you get, the two departments have already agreed upon the price then?
Correct.
Thank you.
Representative Mills.
Thank you, Madam Chair. There's a statistic in here that the Kinsman building would expand to 27,300 square feet. How many square feet is it today? How many new square feet are we building, I guess would be my question.
I'm sure I don't have the current square footage in there. If you reference the area and what would be included in the addition, I have what it would look like thereafter. So if you take our current square footage of Kinsman, which I don't, plus 27,300, that would be the total square footage of Kinsman in the future.
Am I understanding, thank you, Madam Chair, that the completed facility, including what's there today and with the addition, would be the 27,300?
Plus current footprint.
So the 27,300 is, it's maybe miswritten then, because it says would expand to that. It's really would add an additional 27,300. That's the intention?
No, that is correct. Under this proposal, Kinsman Building would expand to 27,300 square feet total.
Okay, so at some point, if you could provide us with a breakdown, how much is there today and how much is new, I would sure appreciate that. Thank
Absolutely.
You.
Okay, now I'm going to ask some questions. On the front page, on that geo map, which of the little circles go away with this project?
All of the green, Madam Chair.
All of the green. Then my second question is, with this add-on, are there offices in this add-on, or what's going to be? We've heard about storage, but what else is going to be there?
Madam Chair, if you take a look at the picture that I handed out, in the middle area, adjacent to the storage bays, you'll see some windows. Offices will be on the second floor of that. That is for the division director for buildings and grounds and some of his leadership team. On the lower area, what we've projected is some storage for materials. So yes, offices will be in that middle area on the second floor.
Are those offices currently in those orange or green circles that are in the outlying areas?
Madam Chair, some are, yes. So the buildings and grounds director, the custodial director, have offices in the basement of the Capitol right now.
Okay.
They will be relocated to this project if it were to go through and have offices there.
What will you do with that office space if this goes through downstairs?
We've got some really good ideas on how to renovate the basement of this Capitol and make it functional and good for everybody. And if you would look at our strategic space plan, there's some references to that. And I get a little fired up here on this one, because we've seen some examples about what other states have done for an older Capitol building and what you can do to renovate it and make it really functional. So I would be excited if we could do that here.
Well, and I apologize, because I don't remember your strategic plan that you presented, but the dilemma that has come up this week is we don't have meeting rooms. So are you looking for expansion of meeting rooms that have the capability to have hearings?
Madam Chair, to the first part of it, I think that if we would renovate the basement, we would be able to put in more meeting rooms, more hoteling space that could be used during legislative session and throughout the year. Whether we could have hearings down there or not is something that I think we would have to dialogue with the legislature to see how do we want to best utilize this space and what could be the most efficient way to do it. I think anything would be possible. It would be better than what we have right now.
Thank you. Any other questions? Senator Johnson.
So I drive by that National Guard Museum every day on the way to work. So what are you storing in there right now? How do you utilize that building?
Madam Chair, Senator Johnson, I'd love to give you a tour of that sometime. It's in the basement of the National Guard Museum. Our carpenters, plumbers, electricians, that's where they go to work every day. Additionally, we have some different supplies that they use and then take to their job site. Far from ideal, far from befitting of our staff, The National Guard wants it anyway because they can use it for different things, displays within their museum. So if we could move out of the National Guard Museum, I think it'd be a win-win for everyone.
Representative Howard.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a question. You said you're going to sell the maintenance shop to DOT. Is there a bill for that this year, or how is that going to be handled?
Chair. We worked with the Office of School and Public Lands. Representative Howard, I don't think we need a bill to do that, and don't quote me on that completely, but I think we can make that transaction through the Office of School and Public Lands without legislation.
Madam Chair.
Representative Mullally.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm unfamiliar with the National Guard Museum and what is in there. If you move this, is it accessible to the public, and does it?
Yeah, the National Guard Museum is located in downtown Pier, and it's a fully functioning museum. They have people right. come in and out all the time. They have displays in there. So, yes, it's open to the public, and it would give them more of an opportunity to display what they would like is more equipment and history of the National Guard.
Follow-up. So is that in moving the plane and everything that's outside that museum building right now?
I'm sure. They would not move any of the plane or different equipment outside, but they have different historical displays inside that need more room.
One more follow-up. In moving some of this museum stuff to the new proposed building, will that be accessible to the public since we've got maintenance over there? And how will that look? Because I don't see any plans for any public access to this building.
I'm sure to clarify, we're talking about the addition on the Kinsman building here. Is that accessible to the public? Yes, absolutely. It's a public building.
Can I just ask a question? Are you asking if there's any museum artifacts or things that they're moving to this building, new building, or is it going to stay at the museum? I think that's there's some misunderstanding.
Thank you for clarifying that. All of the artifacts and pieces that belong to the National Guard Museum will stay at the National Guard Museum. Thank you.
All right. Representative Howard.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm just going to go back to DOT buying the maintenance shop. So it's other funds coming to you, but how is DOT going to, are they going to be using, requesting general funds to make that purchase?
Madam Chair, Representative Howard, no, I don't think they'll do that. I think that within their budget, within DOT's budget, it's predominantly other funds and federal funds. And from what I understand, in this transaction, they did not have to impact their budget at all for that.
Thank you. Any other questions? Last call. All right. Thank you. We will close this hearing to public testimony and open it up for discussion and or action.
Madam Chair.
Senator Johnson.
I'll immediately move to do pass on House Bill 1020. Second.
It's been moved by Senator Johnson, seconded by Senator Wick to do pass House Bill 1020. Any comments on that motion?
No. Thank you, Madam Chair. I guess just as a follow-up to some of the questions that were asked, I would remind the committee that we asked for follow-up as far as square footage that would be added and whatnot. So we can pass this out, but I would prefer that we slow our roll once it gets to the floor and await the answers to those questions. Thank you.
With that, the motion before you is do pass on House Bill 1020. Those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary, call the roll.
Gross.
Aye.
Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Duba.
Aye.
Wick.
Aye.
Haugard?
Aye.
Nesba is excused. Johnson?
Aye.
May?
Aye.
Mills?
Aye.
Maher?
Aye.
Mullally?
Aye.
Colbeck?
Aye.
Sutton?
Aye.
Greenfield?
Aye.
Breitling?
Aye.
Howard?
Aye.
Hanoff?
Aye.
And Carr?
Aye.
17.
By the majority vote, House Bill 1020 has been passed.
Thank you, Madam Co-Chair. And that concludes our bill hearings for the joint appropriations today. I believe we will, I believe that's all we have. Do we have any minutes? We did all the minutes that we have available to us at this time. Okay. Seeing no further items on our agenda today, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So
I have a motion by Senator Greenfield, seconded by Representative Howard. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. We are adjourned.